Well, welcome and good evening to the Federal Way City Council regularly scheduled meeting for March 15th of 2016. Would you all please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance? And Coach Collins, would you please lead us in the pledge?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, thank you, Coach. All right, well, thank you so much for everyone for being here. We've got a full agenda. We're going to go ahead and start off with the proclamation for the Federal Way High School Eagles boys basketball team. And we've got, they won the state championship shortly ago, and I'll have the deputy mayor read the proclamation.
Okay. Thank you very much. And I would like to invite Coach Collins of the Federal Way High School boys basketball team and the team to gather around the podium. And I will read the proclamation, and the mayor will present it and also present certificates to the team members. So, whereas state champion coach Jerome Collins has led the Federal Way Eagles basketball team to 43 consecutive victories, including a 29-0 2015-16 undefeated season. And whereas the Federal Way High School varsity boys basketball team overcame adversity all season and personified the concept of winning as a team. And whereas these young men of character are not only leaders on the court, but also in the classroom and community. And whereas this team, in the words of Coach Collins, got everybody's best every night out, and we stood the tide, winning back-to-back 4A state championships. And whereas the Federal Way Eagles boys varsity basketball team has earned the respect and admiration of the more than 93,000 residents who live in Federal Way for their sportsmanship, academic success, and perseverance. Now, therefore, we, the undersigned mayor and council of the City of Federal Way, do hereby proclaim the day of March 18th, 2016 as Federal Way Eagle Day in the City of Federal Way and call upon all citizens to observe this day by wearing blue and white and by proudly flying their American flag at their homes or businesses in support of Eagle Pride. Signed, this 15th day of March, 2016.
All right, great. Good job. Gentlemen, let me just squeeze here through real quick. Thank you. So what we're going to do, gentlemen, is I'll go ahead and read the names. Coach, this is the proclamation. Congratulations. So what I'll do is we've got certificates here for each of you. After I read your names, I'll go ahead and give you the certificates. And if you could kind of line up in a crescent, you know, starting over there, and then what we'll do when we're all done, let's take a big group picture, okay? All right. Sounds like a plan. All right. Elijah Nanabu. Christian Jones. Malcolm Cole. Eaton Collins. Ferron Flavors. Michael Henry. Calafino Jada. Jamon Jones. Jaden McDaniels. Jalen McDaniels. Marcus Stevens. Jalen Womack. We've got head coach Jerome Collins. Assistant coach Gemini Davis. Assistant coach Quinn Gillis. Assistant Coach Yana Reed. And Assistant Coach Doug Sloan. And Coach, we also have one for our manager, for your manager, Richard Ogonga.
Say, go Eagles.
Thanks, guys. It's quite an accomplishment to not only win a state championship, but to do it 2 years in a row. It's amazing. So proud of you guys. Okay. We've got, let's see here. Well, in 2 days, it's St. Patrick's Day, and I've got a mayoral proclamation for Irish American Heritage Week. I'll go ahead and read that. Irish American Heritage Week. In this, the 100th year since the Easter Rising, which resulted in the birth of a republic, we pay tribute to those Americans of Irish descent that helped build the foundation of our own American republic. Whereas the nearly 780,000 Washingtonians of Irish descent contribute to our community through their churches, businesses, and charitable organizations, as well as their fine tradition of serving as police officers and firefighters, and whereas Americans of Irish descent have had a lasting impact on our history, hosting amongst them 17 presidents of the United States, including President Barack Obama, who said while visiting Ireland, "It is in times of great challenge, of great change, when we remember who we truly are. We, the Irish and Americans, are people who never stop believing in a brighter future. Never has a nation so small inspired so much in another." Whereas in the pursuit of a brighter future and fighting to protect our values, Americans of Irish descent have served our nation on the battlefields from Gettysburg to the faraway deserts of the Middle East and many distant shores in between. Irish Americans claimed nearly half the Union Army regiments during the American Civil War and have 258 individual Medal of Honor recipients. And whereas as the mayor of Federal Way, I am an American of Irish descent and wish the people of Ireland and Federal Way Benic na fili padraig. Happy St. Patrick's Day. And now, therefore, I, the undersigned mayor of the city of Federal Way, Washington, by virtue of the authority vested in me under the laws of the city of Federal Way and state of Washington and the United States of America, do hereby proclaim the week of March 13th through 19th, 2016, is Irish American Heritage Week. Sláinte, which means health. All right, thank you. All right, now, moving on to Tourism Spotlight, we've got Powell's Wood Gardens, and Deputy Mayor Burbage will do the introductions.
Thank you very much. We're kicking off a new series this evening, and that's our Tourism Spotlight, which is designed to focus on the various tourism venues that we have in Federal Way. We're very fortunate to have quite a number of them, but what we discover is that some of our folks who live in Federal Way are not aware of these outstanding features that we have. So that's one of the intents of this new series, is to highlight each one by one at City Council meetings. So tonight I'm very pleased to be able to welcome folks from Powell's Wood Garden, and we have Monty Powell here this evening, who with his wife Diane developed Powell's Wood Garden. And we have Christine Dillinger, who will be making a presentation. She's the program director for Powell's Wood Garden. And this is a truly outstanding feature that represents a transformation of some property, and I believe we'll be getting more details into a truly outstanding and beautiful feature in our community. And Monty has also brought us some other outstanding features in our community. Many of you are familiar with Village Green Retirement Center, and that's another accomplishment that we can thank him for. So I'd like to invite Christine to come to the podium and for the presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor, and thank you, Council, for having me tonight. I started this presentation with a world-class pleasure garden, and I did not come up with the title world-class for Powell's Wood. That's a designation that garden writer Christina Solwitz, who is the co-author of Fine Foliage, an award-winning garden book from the Garden Writers Association of America. She won for 2013, and it was also top gardening book for 2013. So that distinction comes to us from somebody who's well recognized within the garden community in the United States. So that's quite an honor. Powell's Wood is a pleasure garden, which Jean said was created by Monty and Diane Powell with the intention of being shared with the public. So it was designed with public visitation in mind. And it has been a 501c3 for about 18 months now. So we're just in the early stages of that experience. The property was purchased about 23 years ago, and it's made up of a residential lot and some surplus water district property. There are 3.5 acres under cultivation with another 35 of successional forest. And Powell's Wood stretches from South Dash Point Road down through the valley following Cold Creek towards Redondo Beach. This is a view of what the property looked like before the garden was created. This is after debris cleanup. When the Powells purchased the property, they inherited what had been an unofficial dump site for construction debris. And so that all had to be removed before the property could be developed. And then I'm going to share some images of what is there now. So that's the same space, roughly 23 years later.
Wow.
In 2013, there was a redesign of most of the garden beds. This has improved the garden's appeal, not just for garden tourists, but also plant collectors, horticulturalists. And it's also maintained its appeal to non-gardeners as well. It's a relaxing setting that people use to regroup and unwind from a stressful day when they're just seeking a place to relax. And this is a new feature in the garden. This is a stairwell that takes you from the old space to a new parking area that I'll get to in just a minute. The garden has been open to the public with gradually increasing hours for about the last 15 years. And it started out where we would be open just a couple of days a year. And now we have regular open hours Tuesday through Saturday from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. During the months of April through October. So there's a good stretch of time where you can visit. Visitors find us for a number of reasons. They may come to one of our special events, which is featured or pictured here, our Mother's Day open weekend, or they may find us as a garden tourist. I want to talk briefly about our events and how people find us, and then move into tourism a little more. Our Mother's Day open weekend, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, we serve tea in the garden room here on Saturdays and Sundays, and a lot of people are loyal out-of-towners that come because their family lives here, and they come to visit and bring their family to the garden on a yearly basis. The Storytelling Festival in July is a two-day event where we bring in nationally ranked storytellers from all over the U.S., and then some even from outside the U.S., and they come to tell folk tales and personal stories, uplifting personal stories for all ages, young people through adulthood. And we set up a series of tents in the garden. And the festival is advertised through radio spots on KUOW and KPLU, and a television spot on KBTC. KBTC has reach from Vancouver, BC to Vancouver, Washington, and throughout the Olympic Peninsula. So that's great coverage for their area. We also utilize the local guild system. Storytellers function in guilds, sort of like clubs, and they also are throughout the Pacific Northwest, from Vancouver to Bend, Oregon, and over to Ellensburg. And all of those guilds then do outreach work for us about the festival, which then lets us show off a little bit about Federal Way and all of those communities. Another really unique component of our festival is something we call Tea with the Tellers. And it's a networking event for tellers. And tellers tell us that this is one of the reasons that they will journey from out of state to come to the festival, because this event doesn't happen at any other storytelling festival in the country. And they want the opportunity to sit down with the tellers that we've flown in and get some one-on-one advice and meet them in person and do that networking. So this is a unique draw. The festival has folks traveling from all over to visit. Oh, I'm gonna go back a slide here. So we had folks from North Carolina, from Texas, from California, from Washington and Oregon. And last year we had folks travel from Israel to the festival. So the word is out, and we run two ads in the National Storytelling Magazine, which circulates among the tellers and their followers. And so what happens is that when a visitor is particularly fond of a certain teller, they watch to see where that teller is going to be telling throughout the year, and then they follow them around, a little like a groupie. But that's to our advantage, because we bring in really well-known and popular tellers, and then people will travel to come and see them. Fuchsia Days is a event that we started this past year, and it is to feature the hardy fuchsia collection that Powellswood is known for within the horticulture community, or becoming known for. It's been kind of a well-kept secret up until now. We have over 60 hardy fuchsias in the 3.5 acres of cultivated garden, and then we have another 800 on an acre site that's a quarter of a mile trail walk from the garden. And this past year, we didn't have enough capacity yet to lead tours to that space, but we are hopeful that we will be able to do that. So this year, we took cuttings of 60 of the varieties that we had available and brought them over to the garden and filled the garden room with flowers. And anyone that knows collectors know that they will travel great distances to see whatever it is they collect in mass, whether that's cars or quilts or a particular genus of plant. And so people that are into hardy fuchsias make Powellswood a destination because of the breadth of our collection. And it's unique. It's probably one of the largest in the Pacific Northwest. And there are 13 hardy fuchsia guilds in the Pacific Northwest as well. And I don't know if you knew there was quite that popularity of that genus, but there is. And they then spread the word about this event for us and help us staff it. And then the garden tourist is the other visitor that we get. They find us in a number of ways. One of them is a reciprocal admissions program through the American Horticulture Society. When an individual joins Powellswood or another participating garden, they get reciprocal benefits at all of the participating gardens. So a membership at our garden could get you free admission at a garden in Texas or Louisiana or Washington, D.C. So people who know of the program and are active participants read their guides and make their holiday journey plans based on what gardens they want to see. So that's another way that we find people, or they find us. We are also a part of several networks and are listed on their websites. The Garden Conservancy Northwest Network is what you will find if you search Northwest Gardens on Google. It's one of the first links, and it lists all the gardens of significance from BC to Oregon. And we are hosting their twice a year workshop this coming Saturday. And so we've got folks traveling from out of state to come and stay in Federal Way to attend that event. We also are part of a six garden group called the South Sound Gardens, which is actively cultivating relationships with tour companies to bring in bus tours to see the gardens of the South Sound. And then the Powells fund a scholarship through South Seattle Community College to send an intern to Harlow Carr Garden in England every year. And we've had visitors from England as a result of that ongoing relationship. Another new feature at the garden, which has increased our capacity for events, is the parking green. You may have seen this as you drive past the garden on South Dash Point Way. The green is reinforced with a support system with sand over it that allows the turf to become a parking lot, but it is permeable, letting rainwater pass through. Kudos to the Federal Way Engineering and Planning Department for approving this great green parking project for us. This presentation has been primarily focused on our appeal to visitors from out of the area, but that's not the full extent of Powellswood programming. We also, in our goals, address environmental education and then sustainability, sustainable gardening practices for home gardeners and professional horticulturalists as well. So visit the garden to learn more about those programs or our website or follow us on Facebook. Does anyone have any questions?
Council, you have any questions?
Okay.
Deputy Mayor.
Thank you so much, Christine.
Thank you.
I appreciate your being here, and thank you, Monty Powell, as well.
Yes, thank you very much, Bonnie, and thank you very much, Christine. Okay, now, moving on to Best Starts for Kids Initiative, Sheila Capestany with King County. Thank you for being here, Sheila.
Good evening. Makes me want to go out in the garden. That was beautiful.
It is.
I wanted to give you a quick update on Best Starts and let you know where we are in the planning process and what are the coming months will look like for Best Starts. So we are deep into planning and putting together a comprehensive plan for the investments for children, youth, and young adults. We are looking to have a plan ready to submit to our county council on June 1st, which means we have been doing a lot of work in the last couple of months and are really coming to a draft of the plan that will move forward for the investments that we will then be able to take out into community, and I'll talk about that in just a moment. But in the process of putting our the plan together, so the plan is due on June 1st. What we're anticipating is that it will go through county council in a few months. It will take some back and forth, but hopefully will be approved for September, and then we can start our internal county processes looking to get funds out into our communities by the beginning of the year is what we're hoping for with those investments. So in the process of putting that plan together and working on where we need to be going with Best Starts, we have stood up our Children and Youth Advisory Board. The Children and Youth Advisory Board has responsibility for both oversight and advisory for Best Starts. It will also provide oversight and advisory responsibilities for the Youth Action Plan, and then down the road will be available to other planning processes, to the executive and the county council, if they need to have some community input on policies related to children and youth. Just recently, we submitted to the county council the plan for the youth and family homelessness prevention implementation, which was the initial collections for funding, $19 million, we programmed to go towards homelessness prevention. So that is being right now considered by the county council. And that plan is really about people who are at imminent risk of homelessness, not people who are currently homeless, or people who might be if things continue down the road, but right now, this is the issue for them. And that plan includes both a flexible fund to be able to provide some assistance financially to people who are at imminent risk, but also includes funding for case managers. So once people are, the immediate crisis is gone, they have some opportunity to work with someone to say, okay, how did we get here and how can we change that path for you going forward? So that plan is being considered right now for the council. The Children Youth Advisory Board that we have stood up has met twice now officially, and they considered that plan before it was sent to the council. That board is made up of 40 members. 36 of those positions have been appointed already. Three of them are guaranteed spots for youth, people who are under 24 years of age. So we currently have people on the board who are under 24, but they're not filling those youth spots. We are in the process just now of getting those appointments made to that advisory board. And the advisory board is really a different way of doing boards for the county. We are have formed this board with some known leaders, but with a lot of new leaders. It reflects the diversity of our county, both geographically, ethnically, language-wise, age diversity. We were very clear to also want to have that. And represents various different expertise of different folks in the field. Some people who are working with the very youngest, some who work with young adults, some people who work across that age span, and then particular issues. In particular, we want to make sure that we are engaging with kids who have been in foster care, kids who are touching the juvenile justice system, and people with developmental disabilities, in addition to our universal needs for children. We have a member on our board who is directly from Federal Way, and that is Therese Moore, who is the partnership director at Federal Way School District. So she has been a really big supporter and a very good member on the board. So what happens next is we are, as we are forming up the plan would that we're sending to council will include the outcomes that we expect to achieve with Best Starts, the program strategies that will get us there, and then broad funding strategy to go with that program strategy. Once that is submitted to the council, we'll be doing a lot of work over the summer to talk about, well, what does that really mean in terms of our RFP processes? How will community engage with us in that process? With the intention that the majority of the dollars goes out into our communities and does not just stay within the county. So we are about to start the second phase of our community engagement. We did a big process this summer and fall, right before the levy passed. We're going back to community and say, we asked you, this is what we heard, this is the plan we put together based on that, did we get it right? So that will be happening at the beginning of April through mid-April. They're geographically based, and we will have a conversation out in South County, probably a couple of conversations this way. In addition, we've got a website which we have just launched and updated, and a new blog that we're using to keep everyone updated. And that has at least weekly posting, and often it has several more times a week so that people can get information and figure out what's happening. So that's very broad strokes on Best Starts and where we are at. Is there any questions for?
Well, great job, Sheila. Council, any questions? Councilmember Honda.
Thank you very much. I heard you speak Thursday at the DVI meeting in Sea-Tac. So you've been really busy.
Yes.
The homelessness prevention plan that is in progress now, how would someone find out about that? And where would they go to seek help with that?
So how would an individual, or how would
an
organization?
An individual.
Well, it's going to go two ways, that people who are homeless, we are hoping to partner with our school districts, and we'll assume that we get a lot of people coming through the school districts. But one of the most important parts about the plan is who we partner with to do the work. And we are looking for going deep into communities with people who might not be traditional folks who work with homeless, people who are homeless, but who might know, who might get kicked out because something is going on in their home, or who might not be able to pay the rent and is behind in their rent for months. Those are the sorts of agencies that we are looking to partner with. So that is going to be the biggest way that people find out, is through the folks that are already working through with them, or through the schools, or through their healthcare, whatever partnerships they have in connection.
Okay, thank you.
Council, any other questions or comments? Well, thank you for the work you do.
Thank you.
We really
very
appreciate
much.
It. It's exciting. Okay, now moving on to Mayor's Emerging Issues and Report. We've got a 30th District Legislative Town Hall meeting with our Senator Mark Molosha and our two State House representatives, Representative Kochmar and Representative Hickle. That'll be this Thursday, March 17th. Yes, that's St. Paddy's Day, at 6:30 p.m. Here in Chambers. So it'd be great to see you all here, and it's an opportunity to sit down with your legislators and really hear about what's going on under the dome. We've got a neighborhood connection, or what we refer to as our town hall meetings or neighborhood connection meetings, will be at Saghalie Middle School next month on April 13th at 6:30 p.m. So put on your long-term calendar, Saghalie Middle School, April 13th, 6:30 p.m. Hope you can make it. That's a great opportunity where City Hall really comes out to all the directors, the council members are there. It's an opportunity to really hear. I'll be there giving a presentation, our police chief, and talking about issues with the city and about how you can get involved, and gives you really up-to-date information about what we're up to. And we want to hear from, most importantly, we want to hear from the public. So April 13th, 6 p.m. There was homelessness is obviously a big issue in this region, and there was a convening of cities on homelessness that was last Friday. We've got a report from our chief of staff, Brian Wilson, and it was through the Sound Cities Association, of which I'm a board member. Brian, you're on.
Thank you, Mayor, Council, citizens. It's my pleasure to present to you a briefing on the convening of cities that occurred last Friday. The background of this initiative is that an agency called All Home was contracted to provide these services for cities in King County, and this was the first convening of this effort. All Home's new strategic plan sets out to make homelessness rare, brief, one time, and to build community to address the homelessness crisis that's currently in place. Plans call to bring King County cities together to foster collaboration between first responders, human services staff, and other city staff, and officials to strengthen the response to homelessness within and across communities. The purpose of this effort was to build relationships across city departments to foster interdisciplinary responses to homelessness, highlight cross-sector efforts to bring city governments and residents together to respond to local needs, and engage cities in regional collaboration, because the challenges of homelessness do not stop or start at a city's border. The desired outcomes that were identified were: one, learn how cities are experiencing and addressing issues related to homelessness, receive information regarding promising practices and how these practices can be applied throughout King County. And lastly, there's an annual conference that's scheduled for June 1st of 2016 to discuss the promising practices that have been implemented since this convening that occurred last Friday and identify next steps to build upon this work. So again, this took place at the Tukwila Community Center last Friday. It was from 8 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. Federal Way was well represented at this effort, and we had Thaddeus Hodge, a police officer in our department, Michael Morales, our community development director, Jeff Watson, the community services manager, council member Honda, and myself, who attended this effort. So several of the presentations identified promising practices that are happening throughout the county, and these are the ones that were highlighted that were brought to everyone's attention. The first was a Redmond task force on homelessness that was a combination of the police department and their city staff, and how they engage the homeless community and address their needs. There was a City of Bellingham homeless outreach team, and how they built relationships and housed people who were chronically homeless. There was an example of the faith-based community and how they provided safe parking for people who were living in their vehicles. There were some discussions about new approaches to community policing and homelessness, which was, they had a representative from the Portland, Oregon Police Bureau who was present. They had several very impactful people who have been homeless, and they told their stories. A youth individual, an African-American woman in her mid-30s, I would guess, and an older gentleman, and showed their differences of what their experience was. And then there was a time for regional and city discussions about issues that each city was facing. So a summary about some of the things that are happening in Federal Way, and I'm happy to say that there's a lot of things that were highlighted as best practices or promising practices that are currently present here in Federal Way. A coordinated approach to human services, that is something that, you know, our staff and with the faith-based community and those services, there is communication, and there's always opportunities to enhance and improve upon that, but we have a good baseline here in Federal Way. The strength of our faith-based community and a reach-out program is a great example of that. The police department, their community and problem-oriented policing approach is very consistent with the best practices that were provided at this deal, and we have a good reputation and do a good job in that regard. Strength of our nonprofit human service providers. We have our planning for day center services that's ongoing. And recently we have initiated a unified command initiative to address homeless camps and provide service referrals to those who are present within our community. So in summary, we'll continue to participate in this regional effort. I think one thing that I came away with was that it's important with this effort not to just focus on individual cities and what their responsibilities are. I really believe this is a regional issue, and that there has to be regional dollars and regional solutions that are identified to address this, and it should not be left just to individual cities to be responsible for. Some of the promising practices that were identified and put forth had dedicated funding services associated with them. So a lot of the things, there has to be money associated with that, and some of those funds are often come from many different mechanisms, not just city coffers. And last, we will continue to enhance the coordination of our service providers in the City of Federal Way, and that effort is ongoing. And that's the end of my report.
All right, Council, any questions? Thank you, Councilmember Honda, for going. Any observations?
Thank you. I came away from the conference a little bit confused about the homeless situation in Federal Way, and I'm looking forward to having more discussions with those that provide services to those in Federal Way. But I do agree that, you know, especially with the one-night count, our count was up, but that doesn't mean that that's an accurate count. It's something that got a lot of people upset, but we don't know that it's accurate. We actually know that it's not accurate. And it didn't list any homeless youth. And talking to our police officer that was there, I was happy to find out that he doesn't see homeless youth out in the camps, the homeless camps, which is great. But we know that we have homeless youth here. So anyway, I'm a little bit more confused about the situation, and I think that we all need to come together and figure out what's really going on in Federal Way and how to address the issue.
Okay. Well, there's a lot of work that's done. Jeff Watson actually provided some information. What was the percentage of folks that were in their cars? Michael, do you recall?
Jeff's back here.
Oh, okay.
The percentage of people in cars is about 75% of the total number this year. The total number was 263. The number of cars was about 191, I believe. So it was about 75% of that.
I'll do for the recording. He said that, you know, of the 260 that were identified on the one-night count, 193 of those were in vehicles, mm-hmm. which is a huge number and speaks to the mobility and the crossing of jurisdictions that
right.
the homeless population
I think it's obviously very difficult to put your finger on, and, you know, obviously if certain cities have you know, certain types of actions that can push individuals in cars over to another. So it's, you know, we did take a look at other cities and see where their numbers are at. So
there's some additional numbers too, just in terms of the economy, and there was some statistics, and I'll err to bring those forward right now, but if for every $100 that rent goes up, there's a certain percentage of people that it pushes to the threshold of homelessness. And so the economy, the things that are happening with, you know, things going crazy in the Seattle area in terms of cost and real estate and rents, and that transcending down south, that is one of the big issues that is facing and contributing to the homeless problem that we have now.
That's right. All right. Councilmember Honda.
What I did come away with, though, is that our day center, when that opens, will be a big help. And I think it's going to be opening hopefully by July, is what I've heard from the day center people, if everything goes forward as planned. So anything that we can do to help move that along, I would appreciate.
Well, we've yet to receive a permit application from them, so we can't move along until we receive that. Councilmember Maloney.
Thank you. I just want to thank you for the report. I had wanted to attend that briefing, but the space was limited, so I deferred to Councilmember Honda, but I'm just teasing you. But it is something I think that most of us on council probably are really concerned about. So I really appreciate the report. And if there are other ways that I'll just speak for myself, but I assume that it's felt by the other council members. If there's other ways that we can contribute, please let us know.
Thank you.
Right. Councilmember Sepha Dawson, then Deputy Mayor Burbidge, and then Councilmember Moore.
Just briefly also, it's clear that housing stock is not there, it's not available. So this issue is gonna be very, it's gonna continue. And even for the housing authorities that do have Section 8 vouchers and public housing, it's a three-year wait for people to even get into housing, you know, affordable housing. So, you know, just wanted to add that to this conversation because it's really important. You know, homelessness is a big issue, and it's going to be here for a long time. So
great. That was one of the things that was highlighted in the city of Bellingham was exactly that the they were proud of their percentage drop in homelessness through different programs, but once the availability of housing stock shrunk, the amount of homelessness went up and their percentages went up. So there is a correlation, direct correlation to the impacts to homelessness with what's available for housing.
All right, thank you. Deputy Mayor Burbidge.
Thank you. I appreciate your sharing the report, Brian, and appreciate all of those who attended. And I know that there was a strong interest among council members, and we would have had several there, but I know that the space was limited and they were trying to have it. Representation from all the cities in King County. But I also want to express appreciation to the community members who step forward on a regular basis to help with programs for those in need. We have so many grassroots groups in Federal Way, and one of the first that developed was Community Caregiving Network, and Fusion, which provides transitional housing, pretty much grew out of that, and then Reach Out with its shelters, and now the day center that's being planned. And we, of course, have the outstanding work of the multi-service center, and in addition, so many faith-based community groups that are involved. So I kudos to all of them, and I want to note that we really need to be staying in close touch as this process goes on, because they've made such very impressive efforts in the past and continue to do so. And I know that a lot of those folks can provide important insights as this moves along.
Councilmember Mark Moore.
Thank you so much, Mr. Mayor. And Brian, thank you for your efforts on this. And I think it is really important to recognize the work that's been done for years and years and years, such as the community caregivers, like you just stated. So I appreciate bringing that forward. And I also appreciate people like Cheryl that I see in the audience, people like Sherry, who I see in the audience, everyday people that are stepping up to the plate and trying to address homelessness from the ground level. Because I know that we have many leaders in our community that are doing that. And I think it's really important to recognize that. And this, as it's been stated before me, this is a very complicated issue. And I like the fact that Redmond has created a task force to on homelessness. And I think, you know, we've discussed the homelessness in our Human Services Committee when Councilmember Hondo was a chair, and now Copain is chair, and there's just not enough time to discuss it. So I would actually urge and see if there's an opportunity to create some sort of task committee where we have an avenue where we can discuss it in further detail, or have a few study sessions that's been discussed in past previous council meetings. So, I appreciate your PowerPoint presentation, and I thank you for putting that together. And I know that in our second page for my colleagues on the council, for the desired outcomes, you know, one of the things I would like us to look at is what's the root cause of homelessness, and what causes that? And I think we've heard housing is one of them, and the other one is jobs. And I think that's something that I'd like to add to the plate of conversations. And how do we address homelessness from the standpoint of individuals that are standing on the street corners? You know, we've heard day in and day out that, you know, people are disgruntled for seeing panhandlers. Clearly, there's a legal issue that we cannot handle. So how do we address it through another way? How do we be proactive in that? And those are some things I want to see us to discuss, if that's so.
Well, Councilmember Moore, we hear that about the pandering, and just in the past, the panhandling. Just in the past year, 2015, we amended the panhandling statutes twice. Once in regard to closeness or proximity to ATMs, and the other in regard to aggressive begging to where it would get into or obstructing traffic.
Yeah.
The United States Supreme Court won't let us go any further.
Exactly. Yeah, and that's exactly what I'm saying, is that, you know, we've done everything we can from the legal perspective, and I appreciate that work that we've done, but, you know, how do we go after and support the people that are staying on the street corners and be proactive and different and approach things differently with those individuals by saying, hey, would you like to get a job? And I know that I've stated that Albuquerque, New Mexico has been doing this and whatnot. And I know we've discussed that slightly. But the last thing I'll say before I end is, you know, I'm glad that we're getting cities involved in this, and I'm glad we're coming together and discussing this. But there are good lessons and practices that are happening nationwide. And I'm hoping that we can kind of take a look at what's the nation doing in this arena. So a lot of things to discuss, and I'm hoping that there'll be an avenue where we can have clearer conversations and guidelines for what Federal Way can do.
Councilmember Duclos.
This is a very complex problem. I was on the original committee to end homelessness, the 10-year plan. And one of the things that we discovered that people were being drawn to this state from other states across the country, some as far as away as Florida, because we had more services that were available for people. Now, I'm not saying we should cut back on services, but it's a very, very complex problem, and it's not something we're going to solve overnight. And I think we need to be aware of that. There are some people that choose to be homeless. I have a problem. There was a hotel that was bought with public dollars, and it was in Seattle. And the people that went there, they were homeless, but they weren't required to have any services. They could drink and do whatever they wanted in those units. And I didn't see that we were helping anybody with that kind of a program. And I see that somebody's done something down there, and there's laughing going on. But this is a very serious issue. It's a very difficult issue. But we also draw people into this state because of the services that we do have. So I do think if we're going to take taxpayers' dollars and spend it, we need to try to have some successful outcomes for people too.
All right, thank you. Councilmember Hondo.
Thank you. Today at the King County Council had a committee meeting on human services, and they spent an hour discussing homelessness in King County. And they did put it, they actually, when they started the discussion, they said they were only going to spend 1 hour on it, because you could talk forever and ever on homelessness. It is very complicated. There's a lot of things that go into being homeless. Some people will always be homeless, and that's by their choice. Or some people are unable to go to shelters because of illness or whatever. But I would, welcome more discussion, but I also think we need to start at King County and ask King County for their help. They've got the money, and we need to be getting some assistance from King County.
Well, I concur with that.
Right. You've said that many times, Councilmember Duclos. Thank you, Councilmember Honda. All right, Councilmember Moore?
Yeah, just to add, one of the things I forgot to mention, that feels really important. I know I've had individual conversations with some of my colleagues on this, is there's a lot of things that we're doing, as stated on page 4 for us, under the convening of cities. There's a lot of things that we're doing. And one of the things that I would like to ask or put out there is, can Federal Way develop a plan to reduce homelessness, have our own plan? I want us to see a plan that we create where we have all these things encompasses in the plan, and move forward from that.
So I mentioned as part of the planning is that we have just convened. Where's my notes here? A unified command initiative to address homeless camps and providing service referrals for those that are homeless. And this is a huge critical issue for us as a city currently. Not only to be well coordinated in terms of our resources and providing those services to people that are in need, but also having a plan to deal with those who refuse services, who are drug and alcohol dependent, and who are committing crimes, property crimes and persons crimes within our jurisdiction. So we are part of a regional effort, and we've Steve Neal, who's the deputy chief within the police department, has been assigned as the incident commander for this. When I mean unified command is that every department within the city, community development, public works, parks, police, mayor's office, IT, everyone is a part of this effort, and our goal is to tackle this huge problem here over the next 6 to 9 months.
And it is, I can tell everybody here, that it is a huge public safety and health issue. On the day of the Tammy Campbell, the superintendent of public instruction here in Federal Way, on the day of her speech, myself, the police chief, and two of the deputy chiefs went to a location north of Steel Lake where there had been a major fire that had been started because of a makeshift camp, and multiple trees within probably about 50 yards from a whole row of houses had gone up in flames in a huge fire that the fire department had to truck in and put this fire out. So I wanted to put eyes on this, and I actually went out there and hiked in with the chief and the two deputy chiefs and Officer Hodge. And you it would stagger the mind to how much debris is back there. And then this is on privately held property, but there are a number of locations in the city in which there are needles strewn everywhere, there's garbage everywhere, there's hulked out cars. It's a public safety issue, and it's a health issue with all the needles. There was a huge fire. If that had occurred in the middle of summer, we may have lost that entire forested area, and not to mention the houses right next to it. They were using literal propane tanks out there. So it was camp after camp after camp. This is a public safety issue. That's a health issue. And so that this is why we're getting all of the departments on board, because in addition to privately owned land, there's also city owned and land, and we just can't allow these kinds of rampant garbage, needles, this health and safety issue to occur in the city. So that's one of the things we're addressing. So trust me, it's an all hands on deck in which our the department directors, and that, you know, we put through $1 million a year out of human services funding, directing and assistance to people in this community. But there are certain things that we need to make sure we do as well. So that effort is ongoing. Chief, did you have anything else?
No, thank you.
All right, let's move on. More to follow. Yes, you're right. It's going to be, we're going to hear a lot more about this. All right, the next thing is, as many of you may recall, we had a big meeting here last November, November 19th, in regard to air traffic noise. And while there was a lot of noise on that meeting, there hasn't been a lot, and there's been a great turnout, and we really were able to engage not only the FAA, but the airport, and the neighbors that have, are our neighbors that have been concerned about this. Well, there's been a lot of work behind the scenes since that time, and I've asked our chief of staff, Brian Wilson, to give us a report on the status and the progress of the Sea-Tac airport noise. I just want to let you know, though, before we get started, I've had conversations with our Congressman Adam Smith, as well as senior staff with Senator Murray's office about this very issue. But that's only part of the equation. Brian?
Thank you, Mayor, Council, and citizens. Just to give a briefing of where we have been on this issue, we started receiving citizen complaints about noise and increased air traffic around May of 2015. And that most of those complaints focused on increased noise from takeoffs and landings out of Sea-Tac, changes in flight patterns and elevation through different neighborhoods, increased number of flights, you know, takeoffs and landings, and citizens believing there's a significant change over the summer months of this type of activity. So we had a meeting with Sea-Tac airport officials on July 8th of 2015, and some of the areas that we came away with from that meeting, as well as talking to our citizens, was one, the main runway in Sea-Tac, it was under construction, and they had a 6-month permit to redo the main runway, and that was from April through October of 2015. So what that did is push the flight to the two other runways as a result of that. The summer months are warmer, greater of number of days with wind, noise, and air traffic is more noticeable. There's oftentimes much more of a north wind during the summer, and that has the flights coming in, landing to the south. And while 65% of the flights into Sea-Tac are from the south, there's a greater percentage during the summer month because of the weather pattern. The Green Skies Initiative that was passed by the FAA authorized satellite navigation for takeoffs and landings as a fuel-saving measure. It's a very precise patterns that are part of this effort, and there's also a steady decline to land and a steady takeoff period as opposed to the stepping that had taken place before. There has been a significant increase in flights to and from Sea-Tac. Year to date, between July 14 and July 15, there was 13.4% increase. And Sea-Tac is identified as the fastest growing airport of the top 20 airports in the U.S. So we have had ongoing communications, as Mayor Farrell said, with Sea-Tac Airport and Port of Seattle officials, with the representatives of the Federal Aviation Administration, the FAA. We've had conversations with our state representatives, with our county representative, and with our federal representatives. As the mayor mentioned, conversations with Adam Smith, who in turn has had conversations with the FAA, and we have had conversations with the FAA, as well as representatives from Senator Patty Murray's office. One of the things with our meeting that we had here is we engaged some very bright and very knowledgeable citizens who have a great deal of experience in this area, and we have received a great deal of information that we have processed, that we've forwarded to our partners in the FAA and Sea-Tac, and it's really helped to narrow down the scope of the issues that we're addressing. We have, and that meeting I was speaking about, as the mayor mentioned, was November 19th of 2015. We have had follow-up correspondence with citizens who've been concerned and who attended this meeting, and that was with a last email by the mayor to all of those citizens on November 25th, 2016. We had a scheduled meeting that took place on January 13th of 2016, which was with the Port of Seattle CEO, Mr. Flick, and the Director of Real Estate and Economic Development, Mr. Utterback, which was a very productive meeting in terms of what's happening with the port, what our issues here in Federal Way pertaining to Sea-Tac noise, but also talking about economic development opportunities and partnerships between the City of Federal Way and the Port of Seattle. We have had ongoing discussions with Ms. Diane Fuller, who is a senior advisor out of this Northwest office of the FAA. She's been a great partner and has answered several specific questions for us that have been posed not only by our community members, but as part of our efforts to have questions answered. So as part of that, we had asked the FAA following the meeting in November to research and provide a response document to us about the common themes and the questions that arose from that November 19th meeting. And I have a copy of the document here. I think you have one on the dais here as well. These are very complicated, very technical issues, but yet this is an official document that has come from the FAA and is part of our ongoing dialogue with them to find solutions that can meet the concerns of our citizens. I mentioned that we've had great information and documents that have been provided by interested and concerned citizens. And we have a meeting scheduled with the FAA during the week of March 28th. It isn't finalized yet, but it will occur that week. And this is to address several of the options and the content of this letter that you have a copy on your desk regarding, and the title of it is FAA Responses to Federal Way Noise Concerns, February 2016. So a couple of sample questions from this, which they've provided answers to and provide opportunities for us to find solutions to these problems. One, what options are available to mitigate noise issues in the South, including changes to altitude, procedures, flying further out before making a turn? What would prompt a new environmental review? Another question is there flexibility to make changes in the South End that are within the scope of the current environmental approval and review? And another is, can aircraft be required to be at higher altitudes? And if that is the case, what are the steps that need to take to have that, you know, coordination for that to occur? And those are some of the follow-up agenda items that we will have with our meeting later this month in March. So we have, we will have correspondence with our email group in March, probably sooner than later, with providing an update as to where we are today, what's happened since November 19th, and where we are today, and what are the next steps moving forward. We will continue to work in partnership with Sea-Tac Airport, Port of Seattle, and FAA to address concerns. I've had nothing but cooperation from them in terms of their efforts to really tackle some of these real difficult issues, and I'm optimistic to keep moving forward to find solutions to these problems with them. And our efforts to address, you know, Federal Way citizen concerns is ongoing. So I've posted this before in terms of if citizens have questions about what's happening with flight patterns. That information is available on a website, which you can access here. And then my name and also Ms. Linda Stewart, who's the Director of Community Partnerships at the Port of Seattle. She's available as well. So that's, thank you. All
right. Councilmember Honda.
Thank you. Thanks for the report. I have two questions. One, the correspondence that the mayor has with the email group. Are we included in that as council?
Yeah, you can be. We'll provide whatever we provide to them. We'll provide you.
Okay, thank you. And are we or will we be working with any other cities such as Des Moines, Burien? We're not the only city affected by this, and the more we partner with other cities, the stronger we might be.
We have been offered to participate in the Highline Forum, which is a group of the neighboring cities with Sea-Tac and Des Moines and Normandy Park and some of the cities on the south. And I intend to participate in those meetings. But I also believe it's important for us to address our issues that we have specifically and find solutions to those as well. But we will, as opportunities present themselves for that, we will explore those.
Are the issues that we have different than the issues that those cities have?
Yes.
Do you know what those?
Well, it's about noise contours. It's about where the noise is. I
mean, it's about elevations. It's about where the turns take place. Most of those turns take place over Federal Way, as opposed to going a little bit further or higher elevation, which would address the noise issues within our community. And that's a focus of our effort to have some adjustments to the policy, which provides, there's many different agencies in terms of what has to happen to make that happen, but that is an issue and an option that's specific to Federal Way.
Thank you.
All right, Council, any other questions? Councilmember Maloney.
Thank you. I realize that this, you know, the responses are very technical. There's a lot of yes, no's, that kind of stuff as well, and then they go into explanation, but one question I've asked repeatedly and have not gotten an answer to, and I don't mean from you, I just mean in general, it just seems so simple, but I know it's incredibly complicated. If the turns are happening over Federal Way, why can they not be happening over I-5 instead, parallel to Federal Way, And then does, I mean, I know it sounds, it's probably a really complicated answer, but I really still want to know why something that seems like it could be simple as a solution isn't a solution.
So that is one of the direct questions that we've, and I think based on your feedback and other citizens' feedback, we've heard that very often. And as part of our discussion of these of this FAA document, I think on page three or four, there's specific questions pertaining to that in terms of what it takes. And there's certain, and I am not an air traffic controller, or but there's certain procedures that need to be coordinated if those changes were to occur, because it goes into landings and takeoffs as well. It goes to how it connects with the military use. It actually pertains to Boeing Field as well, too. They have a policy from a safety standpoint that they won't have different directions from those two airfields. They have to be in concert. And so there's quite a synthesis that occurs in terms of policy. And we are focused on that issue, you know, about having altitude be a little bit higher, and that the decision of when the turn takes place to have that at a higher altitude and a little farther out over industrial areas.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, that's actually part of what's really meant in that, on that sample questions. This is what we're going to be on page 7 of the PowerPoint.
Okay.
That's what we're going to be talking about.
Okay.
About where exactly can they make those turns?
Okay.
Can it be over water, over I-5,
right.
You know, that kind of thing.
Right.
That's really the heart of the issue.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, thank you.
Brian, council members, any other questions about that issue? All right. Thank you, Brian. There's been a lot of work on this, and a lot of it's obviously been, back and forth with FAA, with the airport, but the dialogue continues. So we'll keep you informed. And we'll definitely include you and let you know what we send out to the email list. Okay. Let's see here. Federal School District is having a We Step Up Color Run 5K Saturday, March 26th at Celebration Park. That's going to be a great event. And so, again, Saturday, March 26th, Celebration Park. It's put on by Federal School District. All profits will be donated to a community in Ecuador via agriculture and food security pillar of life. And pre-registration is recommended. It should be a great event. Then there's going to be a student rally immediately after that in support of Federal Schools. All right, now for the most important part of the, before we get there, actually we have Rick Perez, city traffic engineer, city streetlights. Before I moved to citizen comment, city streetlights, Rick Perez. This is in response to a question by Betty Taylor, who asked about putting streetlights on 8th Avenue out here at Federal City Hall. So, Rick.
Thank you, and no, I'm not too surprised that I'm not the most important thing here.
There's no way to get around that after. All right.
Life goes
streets
on.
Streets are pretty important, yeah, as are the lights.
So, starting off with a bit of background, before the city incorporated, we inherited what King County had been doing, which was providing county-maintained street lighting on arterials, and after that, it was up to the neighborhoods or the developers as property developed, and so we ended up with a lot of unmetered Puget Sound Energy-maintained street lighting, mostly billed through Lake Haven to the property owner. A few years after the city incorporated, we began requiring street lighting on all new development and all new street projects. And all of those are metered services that are city owned, unless they're if we get an individual request for an isolated location that is not easy to metering, providing one service cabinet just for one street light doesn't make financial sense. So. But that's the exception. So we've developed different standards, decorative street lighting in the city center area. We have them at all signalized intersections, and then the spun aluminum poles you see here, and we're starting to use LED street lighting. The PSE stuff is mostly on wooden poles, although there's some that are concrete, and they're just luminaire head on a bracket, mostly on wooden poles, and that's what we have in most other areas. So we have about 2,400 that are city-owned, and the ones that are city-owned we maintain using King County, since they also do our traffic signals. And that costs about $200,000 a year. That's between the electricity and the maintenance. We also have about 2,000 that PSE owns and maintains that we pay for, and that's about $240,000 a year. And no, those numbers are not reversed. The difference is PSE's rates include amortization of the pole in the first place. And they also do have a preventive maintenance program. And whereas with the county maintained stuff, they do not have a preventative maintenance program. So basically when people call in and say, hey, the street light's out, that gets added to a list. King County will go out when they have a day's worth and fix them all in one shot. So, based on our latest records, we have about 1,400 streetlights that are PSE-owned and maintained that the property owner pays for. And so we're estimating the expense of taking that over at $310,000 per year. So what's changing is that with our Lake Haven Utility District Franchise Agreement that was recently approved, moves the cost of all PSE-owned lighting to the city from the property owners, with that cost recovery coming from the franchise fee on Lake Haven. So that resolves a long-standing inequity that we've had in the city. So some of these different types that we see with these, they look a little different. Some of them are again, the concrete or wood poles, but a variety of decorative ones as well in some neighborhoods. Now, we get a fair number of new lighting requests, and but we don't have a whole lot of budget to account for that. So when we get a request, we look at it from the perspective of, does it resolve any pattern of nighttime collisions? And because if there is, you can count on about a 10 to 20% reduction in roadway collisions. We do not consider crime prevention, although that's, you know, a lot of people have the perception that it's gonna make things safer, and it may in certain circumstances, but over the long haul, the evidence is really uneven about whether it actually improves safety in the neighborhood. And so Traffic Division has not historically considered that as a criterion. As I mentioned, the budget we have for new lighting is pretty limited, $10,000 a year. And if utility service is underground, that may cover one. If it's overhead, it depends on how close a transformer is. If there's a transformer on that particular pole, essentially it's free. PSE will mount it and then they just start billing us. If there's a transformer, it's about $500 for a transformer. If they have to run additional wire to service that, then we'll pay for that as well. And then also, you know, it's not just the capital cost of getting a streetlight installed, but each one is $120 to $250 per year to operate and maintain, and that depends on what the wattage is. Most local streets are going to be 100 watts, and that's the $120 a year. So, LED lighting is coming more and more often. We've been putting them on our capital projects now for about 4 years, and we are now requiring them on new development as well. It does cut power consumption about half, and the payback period associated with that is about 7 years, because it is more expensive up front. We have adopted interim standards. There are no national standards at this point. They keep promising they'll introduce them here shortly, but haven't seen it yet. We have no retrofit program identified or budgeted. So, moving forward, one idea is to have a new capital program which could be implemented in the next budget cycle. The first phase of that would to be to develop a system-wide analysis and prioritization criteria. That is not a small effort given the number of streets that don't have any street lighting at all. Some potential priorities and criteria we could use for that, obviously collision reduction, but also transit and school bus stops, pedestrian and bicycle corridors, improving the other areas in the city center that don't have lighting at this point, whether we want to start introducing a program to retrofit street lighting to LEDs, and also, as I mentioned, because of the more expensive maintenance with PSE, to convert some PSE-owned and maintained unmetered service to city-owned and county-maintained service. So, with all that background, the street lighting request for 8th Avenue South here, estimating that 7 or 8 street lights would be required. Because it's all underground, it would cost about $70,000 to install that. Our criteria being based strictly on nighttime collisions, we would not recommend moving forward with that because there are no reported collisions occurring at night as far back as our collision records go. And so we would recommend instead to fold this into an overall prioritization of system-wide needs. So with that.
All right, council, any questions? Councilmember Maloney,
thank
and
you.
Then Seva Dawson.
Thank you. Thank you for that, Rick. I think that it's really eye-opening to see what the costs are associated with that versus what the potential benefit overall of adding new streetlights anyway, where there once weren't any. I do have a question that I've actually talked with Marwan briefly about, but I want to just kind of pose it here to get a better understanding of it. There's a company that is located here in Federal Way, Marwan, you may remember this conversation, that does LED streetlights, and they have offered a free one to us just to kind of try it out. And I don't know if that would be cost effective in the long run to do that or not, and that might be the sticking point that you mentioned. But the thing that's attractive about that the concept that they offer, not necessarily only them, is that it's the LED, and they have kind of beacons on the top so that if there's an emergency vehicle coming through, it's red, and you can see what's coming through. And the other is that it can be wired somehow. I don't know exactly how. I didn't listen that closely. But it can be wired so that as time goes on, we can become a wired city, which would be good for, business and homeowners alike. So if there's something that is, if you don't mind, just kind of fill me in on that.
Yes, Councilmember Maloney. Yes, we met with the company, and the free portion of it is not to install a new street light. The free portion is to retrofit an existing street light, which means that you have to have the investment already there. They will just change the regular street light into an LED. And yes, they do have the possibility of having cameras on those lights or having the opticom where the light will be flashing during an emergency event. If an emergency vehicle passed by, the light will start flashing, and that will give a warning to everybody in addition to the sound of those lights. We look at that option, and as a matter of fact, what they recommended is for us to use it on Pacific Highway. And some of Pacific Highway at the present time do have the regular street light, and we are converting all of those as part of our new project into LED. Mm-hmm. So the option is still there. We looked at it, and we felt that having camera on those lights, it really does not fit into the city need because we already have Safe City within the downtown area, and we already have the camera, so there is no need for additional camera. And as a matter of fact, we work with IT to find out if there is a need in that particular area for additional cameras. For other areas, it has to be part of a system. And when we looked at it, we really want to have a control. If we're going to have safe city camera, the city must have a control. And in that particular case, with that program, the data will go somewhere else, and then the city have to import it. So the city felt that that option is not a viable option for us because we lose control of who operate the cameras.
Okay. I appreciate that explanation because I wasn't even focused in on the camera aspect of it. I was focused in on the other benefits. So that's very helpful. Thank you.
All right, Council. Any other Council Member Sepadasa?
Thank you. So as we're talking about this and all the changes or whatever future changes that we're going to do to lighting, are they all going to be underground? Is that something we're thinking about? I'm just curious.
At this point, no, because that would not just entail undergrounding for the street lighting, but everything else out there, which, you know, we typically would not do unless we're rebuilding the whole street. And there's also potentially costs to the adjacent property owners associated with undergrounding that either they'd have to pay or we'd have to subsidize.
And also, is Betty going to be informed of this presentation somehow?
Well, yeah, we can.
Unfortunately, she's not here tonight, so.
Right. Okay. Okay.
Thank you.
Councilmember Moore, then Councilmember Honda, then Councilmember Deputy Mayor Burbage. Councilmember Copain.
Thank you so much, Mr. Mayor. Quick things. I appreciate hearing about the LED efforts, and I'd like to see that happen in the future more so. I think that's really critically important. I know that I'm going to say recently we've been focused more on environmental impacts and being good stewards, and I see that as part of that effort. So that's kind of my two cents on that. And I know that we discussed transit lighting, bus stop lighting. And you did a great job let us know about the PSC lights and all that type of stuff. But I'd like to see is Metro in charge of any lighting?
No.
So the lighting that's a part of the bus stops, that's either PSC or the city's.
Okay. So like on the rapid ride stations, they tied into our electrical services since we already had continuous street lighting on the segments of PAC Highway that they're operating on. So we're actually paying for that. Now they went with LED lighting, so the incremental cost is pretty minimal. They maintain them when they're, you know, part of the shelter, but their service fee comes through us.
Okay. And the last part for a second is I appreciate hearing about the collisions efforts. That certainly is important, but I think for me what's also really important is that people feel safe walking. I know I've heard people being concerned that it's dark wherever they're walking, and I think that's incredibly important for us to look at as well.
Yes, and the primary reason why we've been as restrictive as we have is because we don't have the budget to do a lot.
Okay, Councilmember Copain.
Rick, thanks for your presentation. I'm pleased to hear that we're embracing LED lighting. I think that from what I understand as a homeowner, the length of life for the lights is substantially longer, and the power consumed is substantially lower, and the costs continue to go down. And I think it's much more affordable now for me to light my house with LEDs than it was 5 years ago when I began the process. But that being said, is that also true with the lighting in our current inventory of street lights?
Yeah, we are. It is about a 50% reduction in the power consumption for street lighting, not as dramatic as it was when we did the traffic signals. That was about 85% reduction. But we have that, and then in addition, yes, the lights, the lamps last a lot longer. We're assuming at least 10 years. There are some manufacturers that are now warranting for 15 to 20 years. So, and I think that technology will continue to improve as well.
Are the costs continue to come down as well?
They are.
Okay. Just follow up. What's our current inventory of LED versus incandescent lighting or other forms of lighting?
Of the city-owned ones, I'd say we're probably approaching about 60, and we'll probably be up to about 100 by the time we're done with phase 5 and 99.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
All right, Rick, before I forget, would you please get Ms. Betty Taylor's address from one of her prior pink sheets and mail her a hard copy of this presentation?
Sure.
All right. And then Councilmember Honda.
Thank you. Two things. Thank you for responding to a citizen's request. I appreciate that. And if a citizen or a business wanted to get a street light near their place, their residence, is there a process that they have, or do they just call you up? Or
they just call us up and ask.
Okay, thanks.
We'll evaluate it.
Good question. Deputy Mayor Burbidge.
Thank you. Thank you, Rick, for this presentation, helping to put things in perspective and giving us a great deal of information and important updates. But I'd also like to request, if possible, would it be possible to email us this presentation so that we'd have it as a reference point for the future?
You bet.
Okay. That's thank great. You very much.
All right. Thank you. All right, Council, anything else? Rick, thank you very much. Marwan, thank you very much. Appreciate it. I know, Betty missed it, but we can always make sure, we'll make sure she gets all this. Okay, now, the most important part of the meeting is to hear from the public. We've got several pink sheets. Our first speaker is Anthony Marietta, then followed by Ms. Joanne Paquette.
Thank you, Mayor, Council, Deputy Mayor. So I wanted to draw attention to this last week we had a Citizens of the Year Award that was offered to an individual, and I wanted to make sure I acknowledge Presley Anderson, who's the 8-year-old who had raised thousands for victims of the Eastern Washington wildfire. And, you know, it's pretty awesome to see somebody who's so young take the initiative and then do something really powerful. But what that really drew interest to me was I wanted to acknowledge a friend of mine, and you've already done it here today, but it's Sherry Edwards. She was one of the individuals who was nominated for that Citizen of the Year Award. And I'm just inspired and impressed by Sherry all the time. Sherry volunteers and donates clothing, care packets, socks, and other items needed on to the Monday night suppers. I've heard Jim, I've heard you mention the washing event that she does for clothing and bedding every month for the last 15 months. And last fall and winter, Sherry started a tent and sleeping bag and tarp drive for the homeless after hearing about the needs from the homeless at that laundry event. Sherry was also able to raise hundreds of dollars for MSC to provide those items. And she worked with her fellow employees at Group Health and with the local Boy Scout, which I believe her son is, to collect and distribute those donations. Sherry has networked with her friends and neighbors to make it possible to donate and drop off needs for those items at the laundry event every month, and to make sure that the donations get directed to people in need. And Sherry freely gives out her cell phone number, and they know how to contact her when they need something. Networking with her friends, she's also been able to provide them with items such as camp stoves, propane, candles, matches and warmers, clothing, blankets, coats, gloves, scarves, and hats, in addition to tents, sleeping bags, pads, tarps, which is essential during the cold winter. And all in all, what I really just want to do is say how much I appreciate her and how much I'm inspired by her. And some of you might find the humor in this. I know exactly what it's like to run and lose. So with that, I wanted to acknowledge Sherry by seeing what I can do for her. And when I asked her what it is she wanted, she said a donation to the Federal Way Community Caregivers Network. So with that in mind, I wanted to make this $500 donation to them, but I wanted to make sure that it goes on behalf of Sherry Edwards because of all the hard work that she's done, and she's awesome. So Sherry, and to everybody like you, and I think it's rather appropriate that you did so much acknowledgement of the homelessness issue this time. This is for you, Sherry. Thank you.
Oh, yay. Thank you, Sherry. And thank you, Anthony. Really appreciate it. And Sherry, thank you so much for all you do. All right, Joanne Paquette.
Thank you. Mayor, Deputy Mayor, and members of the council, this is the monthly fundraising report from the Federal Way Coalition of the Performing Arts for the Performing Arts and Events Center. We now have informational packets to take around to many of the businesses that are surrounding the PAC site, and we divided up a map, and four of us will start distributing all this information this week. Now that the construction is underway, we wanted to be certain they all knew details about it, and we'll also provide information on contributing to the project, just in case. We're still finding that many know very little about it and about the various activities that can happen there. And we discovered this when we distributed information several months ago and found that several of the business employees don't live in Federal Way, so they aren't that aware of what's happening downtown. So this will be a good opportunity for us to really get the word out. Teresa Yvonne and I did a presentation on the PAC and the history of the coalition involvement in at Foundation House Retirement Center recently, and they seem really interested in that, and that we have one scheduled at Village Green Retirement Community on the 31st. So we're just trying everything we can, you know, to let everybody know what's happening and bring them up to date. And you've already seen the lists of the many rooms and special spaces already named in the PAC. But we have a few left. So we have a check tonight for $10,000, and that's from For Culture, a grant that we'd written some while ago. We'd already gotten 10 thousand of it before. So anyway, that totals $811,679 we have raised. We also have pledges totaling $65,200, and most of those will be paid later this year. And for the remaining balance, we hope a good amount might come through the naming of seats. And they range in price from $2,500 in the front section of the performance hall to $1,000 in the rest of the hall, including the balcony. And the naming plaques will be on the arm of the seats. So that's our report for tonight, and I will trot the check over to Ade, and then we'll have another check, we hope, next time. Thank you.
That's great. Thank you, Joanne. All right, Bob Woolley. And then Cheryl Hurst.
I am Bob Woolley. I'm here to talk about Twin Lakes, and more specifically, Lake Jean. That's part of Twin Lakes and part of the Twin Lakes Golf Club. It was very refreshing, Deputy Mayor, to see the Powell Woods Garden presentation, a gem in the Federal Way tourism attractions. There is another gem. It's the Twin Lakes Golf Club that attracts people from all over the state to come and play in their semi-public course. It is a very good course. It also has a blight. That blight is Lake Jean. If a golfer comes from somewhere in the state to play a round of golf, they never see Lake Jean, particularly in the summertime when it's toxic. And it's toxic, which is a public health hazard. That's the reason I came here three meetings ago and brought the public health matter to the council for assistance. We have, in the interim, met with the two committees, the Land Use Committee and the Public Safety Committee, to get on their agenda for their next meeting session so we can expand the presentations for due consideration. The expectation would be that representatives from the club would be at those two committee meetings if we have two or just one. Mr. Mayor, we meaning Don Smith and I, who are the Lake Jean Resolution Committee members, have gone to the club board and asked to meet with them to try to resolve the differences of opinion, and that's in concert with what you and the chief is trying to do. It's not duplicative, but it's another path to open the airways, if you will. We have an initiative for the DOE to issue a permit. The club holds a permit, and the DOE has indicated that if they hold the permit and choose to do nothing about the toxic conditions, they have the right to do nothing. That is why we brought it to the public. I am speaking to y'all, but I realize that I am also speaking to the Lake Jean residents, the citizens of Federal Way, and those citizens that read the Mirror. You've heard my plea for assistance and partnership in this regards. If we are not able to get a permit, then our real pressure on the club to do something is the nuisance revision that is being worked by the two committees. That is a very important initiative, as well as the dialogue that needs to occur. Mr. Mayor, thank you for what you're doing behind the scenes. We must have a meeting of both parties to bring resolution to our dilemma. And I appreciate all that you're doing. I see my lights blinking, and I'm going to take one more effort.
Go ahead, Bob.
The club presented to y'all a comprehensive plan. That comprehensive plan was not comprehensive. I've provided y'all with the critique that the residents made to that plan, as well as a technical critique. I urge all the board members all the council members to read those documents, because they do provide more insight than what the club's plan is. Thank you. I'm overdue. I'm exiting the podium.
Thanks, Bob. All right. I didn't have the heart to cut you off. We did hear communication from the director of the Department of Ecology. We'll get you that letter if you haven't already seen it. And these efforts are ongoing, where we're talking to both sides. And so more to come, council. I provided you some documentation. Amy Jo.
I just want to make it clear, too, that we've gotten the information from Mr. Woolley. We haven't made any decisions about whether we'll be moving forward with the nuisance change. I'm sorry, a change to our nuisance ordinance at this time. Right. We're still evaluating that.
So. That's right. So we're looking at it. Okay. More to follow. Thank you, Bob. Appreciate it. All right, Ms. Hurst, Cheryl.
Hi. Thanks, Mayor Farrell and City Council people and the citizens are here. Spent a fair amount of time with the homeless people. And first of all, let me commend the city for kind of taking the bull by the horns, because this is, as Susan said, this is very complicated. One of the things that I would like to offer up, I have worked with code enforcement a little bit in Federal Way and recycling and Mark and whoever else I can, you know, speak to here. And I kind of feel like it might behoove the city and the departments to bring in a couple private citizens. Multiple reasons. One, there's a few things that, you know, that go on that, like, nobody ever really knows the answers, but the answer to the big fire, FYI, was somebody getting ticked off at somebody and burning their tent down. And then this guy, you know, basically kind of had to like leave town, you know, but comes back, and then he needs a tent, he needs a sleeping bag. So we call over to the multi-service center, and they're out till 3 or 4 more days. So the reality comes out to is like, there's so many complicated things. And then we talk to the people, it's like, oh yeah, we got a bus ticket from Seattle to come up here. But there is a huge percentage of people, and that's one of the things we've been working with the last couple of months at the laundry event, is to ask them their ages and how long they've been in Federal Way. And the percentages are pretty decent that they've, most of them have been here at least 2 years, and some of them 15 to 18 to 20 years. A few of them we've spoke to have essentially, yes, they do have Section 8 vouchers, and guess what? They can't get Section 8 housing. So there's so many different levels and so many different things. And the last thing before I get some little red light or anything on me is the different organizations, you know, essentially, they are starting to kind of cohesively speak together. And thanks to the police department, Community Caregiving Network has gone out with one of the policemen, kind of gone through some things. And it's just like, every time you guys open another door, more people get more information, and it starts to look like, oh, okay, great, you know, here's another hurdle. So the reality, I guess, is what I'm saying is that, you know, there are private citizens out there that, you know, don't have a problem putting their time out there, and, you know, like I've offered up my time, just because it's not that it should always be the city's problem, but the reality is, firsthand, I've seen a fair amount of garbage and needles, and it's not fair to the property owners that stuff's there either. So, you know, and believe it or not, there's a fair amount of homeless that feel the same way. Right. So, anyways, my time's up, and thanks for your time.
Thanks, Cheryl. Well, thank you for the work you do. Okay, that's my last ping sheet. Is there anybody else who'd like to talk? Okay, thank you very much. All right, now, moving on to the consent agenda. These are items that have already gone through committee. They can be passed all at once. I'll go ahead and read them and then see if any individual items would be desired to be pulled. All right, item A, minutes for the February 20th, 2016 council retreat summary, March 1st, 2016 regular meeting minutes. Item B, agreement with Public Health Seattle King County to provide distracted driving enforcement funding. Item C, Town Square Park permeable pavers. Item D, Town Square Park paver installation bid award. Item E, Town Square Park stainless steel columns bid award. Item F, Town Square Park playground equipment. Item G, clear wireless site lease renewal. Item H, 2016 NPDES annual report submittal. Item I, 2016 asphalt overlay project bid award. Item J, South 304th Street at 28th Avenue South intersection improvements project acceptance. Item K, grant funding for transportation improvement projects, authorization to submit an application. Item L, Olympic View, 2015 NTS, 26th Avenue Southwest, Southwest 328th Street to Southwest 334th Street. Item M, 2016-17 Neighborhood Traffic Safety NTS Program Bid Award. Council, before I ask for a motion, are there any items that the council would want to pull for separate consideration? Councilmember Honda?
I'd like to pull item F, Town Square Park Playground Equipment.
Okay. Council, any other items that wish for separate consideration? All right. Deputy Mayor Burbridge, do you have a, let's see, do you have a motion with respect to items A through E and G through M?
Yes, I do. I move approval of items A through E and items G through M on the consent agenda.
Second.
All right. Is there any, it's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? All right. Now moving on to item F. Before we take that, what I'd ask to do is have item F is the Town Square Park playground equipment. I'd ask for a presentation from our Parks Director, John Hutton. We've got our Deputy Parks Director, Steve Eichert.
Thank you, Mayor, Deputy Mayor, members of Council. Happy to be here tonight to explain our playground equipment that we have at the park. I have some photographs of what was selected by our Parks Commission and run through committee. And I just have to find it one moment here. So these, and these were also displayed this evening on the boards in the back, and those were the same boards that were shown at public events, as well as our Parks Commission meetings, as well as to the committee. So we have several pieces tonight. The piece on the bottom is a particularly interesting piece. That is a 66-foot long zip line. It has two separate tracks on it, so kids can go in both directions. It's a linear space for where the playground equipment is on the north end of the park, just north of the spray feature. So we had a long linear space to fill, and so it created some interesting challenges in getting the right equipment to fit in the right spots and be really fun and unique. And this particular apparatus is very, very cool. Lots of fun for kids of all ages. A lot of fun. So the one on the top left is called the Topsy Turvy. That's a spinning unit. Lots of fun. Kids love to spin. And the one in the middle is the called the Oodle Swing. That's a lot of fun. Kids can swing on that by themselves or with their friends, as depicted in the photo there. So these are the three items that we are up for consideration this evening for our agenda bill to be approved. So any questions on this before I go to the other slide?
Councilmember Maloney.
Thank you. Do you have a breakdown of how much each one of those costs?
Yes, I do.
Including installation and delivery and everything.
These will be the zip cruise, the zip line, the one on the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
Correct me if I'm wrong here, Steve. I have Deputy Director Steve Eichard. The zip cruise, $12,000, is that correct?
Yeah, plus then the installation.
So the zip cruise, the cost of the unit was $12,862. And installation is $3,995.
Okay.
I forgot, there's two tracks in the zip cruise.
So excuse me, it's exactly double that because there's two tracks.
Okay.
I apologize, there's two different lines.
Okay.
So the Topsy Turny is $3,978, and the installation on that is $1,092. And the Oodle Swing is $4,467, and the installation on that is $1,563.
Are these ADA approved?
They're all of our equipment in our parks are ADA compliant. That does not mean they have to meet ADA standard. That does not mean that they're wheelchair friendly necessarily,
right.
But they are definitely ADA.
The Topsy Turny and the Oodle can have our transfer systems where you can pull up to them and transfer onto them.
And we do have the ability to put a special chair on the zip line as well. It would be an additional piece if we chose to put that on if there was a desire to do that.
Councilmember Moore.
Thank you so much. Steve, I think we talked about this briefly in our committee. Did the commission take a look at this, and what was their thoughts and opinions and the conversations?
Sure, we started talking about this clear back in April of 2015. And we talked about it for a couple of months, and we actually had more display boards than what you see in the back. We had display boards of many, many pieces of equipment, and these were even taken out to some public events, and people selected which ones they thought would be the best fit for Town Square Park.
Some of those pieces actually still have the dots. We use the dot system to have people pick their favorites. We pulled some of them off because they were so full you couldn't see the apparatus anymore. The zip line was by far and away the very most popular of them, along with, or excuse me, the was it the dome? The Explorer Dome, we'll talk about in a moment, and the zip line.
Can we show that dome real
quick? Absolutely. So in addition, these are the three pieces that cover the agenda bill this evening. We did have a great opportunity, and we took advantage of it. This is called the Explorer Dome, and this was by far and away the most popular. People just love this particular apparatus. This is called the Explorer Dome. It features lots of different play abilities, from sliding to climbing to swinging. It's lots of fun. They're super popular. A couple of other jurisdictions in Western Washington have them, and we went up, we actually sent a couple parks employees to check them out with their kids. We said, hey, if you're taking your kids to a park, this weekend, check this one out and let us know what you think. Steve has actually seen one in action. I think our mayor might have seen one in action recently with his own little boy up near Ballard. So they're very popular. This is a super fun element. Our Parks Commission was overwhelmingly supportive of all of these pieces of equipment, but this one garnered special attention and special excitement. Comments, we just went back and listened to the meeting today, and comments like awesome, fantastic, fits the theme, really fun. And this is not an inaccurate depiction of how many kids are on those at one time.
There's actually one at Golden Gardens, so it's about that size. That is usually about that many kids. Mm-hmm. Councilmember Moore?
I apologize for taking up so much time. Just wanted to clarify. Was this brought into the 4th of July tent where the public can kind of come in and interact with this? Is that what I heard, or is that a misunderstanding?
I believe they were at 4th of July. Councilmember Kopang probably helped at that event that day. Do you remember if we had this one? I know we had it at Parks Appreciation Day at Adelaide, for sure.
Definitely at Parks Appreciation Day. I did not work the booth that day because I was right in the middle of a campaign.
Okay.
So, but yeah.
But you say this is not part of the budget bill. Why is that?
That is correct. We actually took advantage at the very end of the year. We've been in touch with this playground company, and they had a year-end sale that saved us quite a bit of money. In fact, by purchasing this, we saved about $14,000 for the city, a little over $14,000, between savings on this particular equipment, and they threw in another piece of equipment that we didn't have to buy at all because they had made it part of the package. So we saved $14,000 by buying this at the end of their year sale. They had an end of the year sale. They were probably over inventory and had an opportunity. So we were very excited about being able to buy that and save that money.
What budget did that come out of? And
all of this playground equipment in the entire park is paid for out of our CIP playground account. And that's always been the plan, to pay for it out of the CIP. This is not out of the park budget itself. This is whenever we'd build a new park, we'd try to put a playground in, and we have a playground account for that. That playground account does lots of things. We improve playgrounds. We replace playgrounds when they wear out. We inspect our playgrounds to make sure that when one is ready. We work closely with the Parks Commission. We do a field trip with them each year to assess all of our play systems in our park. And this was identified last year as obviously the next park that would need a playground. So that's where this money will come from.
Councilmember Moore.
Thank you. If this is not approved today, then how does that affect the timelines of everything and the schedule?
Well, this is actually not, this section is not part of that. It's the other three that are.
That's what I'm referring to.
Okay.
Thank you.
I answer your question honestly. I don't think it would be very good for the time frame. It would be hard for me to explain to the Parks Commission, who was very, very adamant about, they loved it. They were excited, each and every one of them. It was absolutely a unanimous vote to move forward with it. It was presented to them on more than one occasion and forwarded on to the committee with their strongest recommendation to go forward. At the committee level, it was asked to study a different design, and we did do that. We took it back to the Parks Commission, and they wanted to move forward with the elements that they picked, which are the ones we're depicting tonight.
Can you go back to those pictures? Three, and then Councilmember Kopang, and then did you have another? Okay, so Councilmember Kopang.
Yeah, I think as a council, it's really important for us to recognize the contribution of the commissions. They have been appointed by us to basically review and do some of the heavy lifting for us as a city and as a council to make sure that that citizens' desires are represented. As a member of the Parks Commission, as the chair, I was definitely involved in a lot of conversations regarding this park. And one of the requirements that we really have as a city is to make sure that we have parks that really do best serve the needs of the entire community. So having every park being ADA accessible is not only a requirement, it's we want to go above and beyond as a city. And in this particular case, we have done that as far as the ADA standards are concerned. I think the commission also really wanted to look at how we could be as inclusive as possible in all aspects. We've got a splash park that is wheelchair accessible. We have features that, while they're not wheelchair accessible, are accessible to people with disabilities. So we've done that and created what I believe is a park that is really a premier play area within our city. I think the commission as a whole was probably as excited about this particular park as they've been about any park, including the Family Fun Center, the Family Playland at Steel Lake Park. So to say that, you know, that there has not been good, considerate work done by the commission, I think is really, I take a little bit of, not offense at it, but it's disappointing to me that we went through this process, we looked at all the options, and I can tell you as a member of that commission, we looked at an option very similar to what Council Member Honda is presenting here to the council tonight.
And she hasn't done that yet. So
well, okay, right. But she's presented pictures to us. And the commission as a whole really kind of said, this is okay, but this does not offer the play value that we as a commission really want to provide for everyone coming to what we believe, that the commission believed could be the premier park within our town core. So having had that background, I just could not withhold that. I think it's very important for us to understand the value of the commission's input in this particular park and the overall design. And Director Hutton, do we actually have a picture of the play area itself and how all these elements would fit within it?
I don't believe I brought one this evening. Do we have everything? I don't think we brought one of okay. anything outside of the four elements that we're talking
okay.
about.
Okay, again, this, you know, looking at the design overall, the all-encompassing look with the play, the splash park, the dome, the zip lines, the oodle swing, the top server, we were able to lay out in a way that it made a lot of sense and really, I think, offered an optimal playability for the kids of our community. So,
right. Councilmember Maloney.
Thank you. I'm wondering about protocol. We've got one piece of equipment that was summarily purchased without council input, all council input, and then this remaining equipment that you are requesting our vote on. So what is the difference between those?
Well, I'll own that completely on my own. We had we took these designs that were selected by the Parks Commission. We took them to committee at the 85%. There was, and they took it back again, and everything was set to move forward. We did not feel there would be any change off of this. And then we had an opportunity late in December, after the only December council meeting, to make a purchase to save $14,000 for the city. So we made that decision, and I'll own that I made the decision to purchase it and save $14,000 of city money with a one-time opportunity to purchase the equipment that we'd agreed upon to buy.
Had that piece of equipment been in the pictures shown to the commission, the committee, and the public?
Absolutely.
Was there any legality issue with regard to your purchase of the, to your understanding?
I don't believe there was any legality issue. We had approval at 85%, and this was part of the 85%. The play area was at 85%. I certainly would never do anything illegal or.
Purchase. Oh, I never.
And purchase went through.
Insinuated that. Okay. My question is. I don't know why it's necessary for us to vote on this if we didn't need to vote on the other. I'm really truly wondering about protocol. Is the city attorney here?
If I may, it was a timing issue is why we purchased that without coming to you exactly like we're doing tonight. Mm-hmm. We didn't have the timing issue that we had to make that purchase and there was no more council meetings. This purchase was made, I believe, on December 24th. Or 23rd, we only had one meeting in December, and then there was a one-time opportunity to purchase it and with the savings, and we wanted to take advantage of the savings. So.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Just a point of clarification. We're talking about item F. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay.
Town Square Park playground equipment.
Thank you so much. And then, obviously, we were presented with this photo. At what point do we discuss that? Just a clarification.
When Councilmember Honda is ready to proceed.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Councilmember Honda?
Thank you. On the zip line, what is the age recommendation and the weight requirements?
Weight requirement, minimum weight?
Maximum weight.
Maximum weight, I believe, is 400 pounds.
Per person.
Per person, 400 pounds per person. It will hold a full size, a very large adult.
How high off the ground is it?
I think it was, the seat, I believe, is in the 2-foot range. I'd have to look that up again.
So it's 2 feet off the ground?
I believe so.
And what's the minimum weight?
I'm not sure on the minimum weight. It would take a small child.
It's rated, the playground rating for this is 5 to 12-year-old.
Okay, thank you.
But it you know, obviously, bigger youth and adults can go on. You know.
And topsy-turvy?
These are all 5 to 12. Yeah.
All rating. 5 to 12, okay, thank
the
you.
National rating for 5 to 12.
And the other piece, I don't know what it's called. What age rating is that for?
The Oodle Swing.
Oodle Swing is also 5 to 12.
Excuse me.
Explorer Dome is
the
5
piece,
to 12.
The piece that you've already purchased.
Explorer Dome is also 5 to 12.
Ah, okay.
So everything that we're looking at is rated for a 5-year-old to a 12-year-old. Okay, thank you. The reason that I brought this forward is, first of all, I'm going to answer some of Councilmember Copeng's statements. I was on the Arts Commission several years ago, in which we spent months coming up with recommendations for the funding that the Arts Commission does. And I know what it's like to be on a commission in which the City Council does not take the recommendations of the commission. That council that year decided to not take any of our recommendations for funding, and even at the request, I was chair of the commission, I requested at the meeting that it go back to the Arts Commission for discussion, and that was refused. So I value our commissioners. I value our citizens who step forward and say that they will provide assistance to us, to our city, with their knowledge and their passion for this city. I really value that. And I know what it feels like to be on a commission in which every single recommendation for funding was not accepted. It hurts. I know what it feels like. I would never, ever say that the Parks Commission did not work in a good, considerate manner, because I know that they did. So that's not something that I have said or would say. Back in August of 2014, my daughter moved to Alexandria, Virginia, and she lived in an apartment in the middle of Old Town. And if you've ever been in that town, it's very tiny, but it's you walk everywhere. And there are playgrounds every other, there's just playgrounds everywhere. But I was very, very impressed with the playgrounds in Alexandria, Virginia. And I was very impressed because I'm disabled. In 2010, the Americans with Disability Act required that all playgrounds be designed and constructed in such a manner that the equipment be readily accessible and usable by individuals with disabilities. There are many types of different disabilities: sensory, physical, visual, and that's just a few. In August, when I was with my daughter in Virginia, we went to many different playgrounds throughout Alexandria and throughout McLean and the other towns around Washington, D.C. And most of those playgrounds had something similar to this. This is something that a child under 5 could play with. Who's going to come to the park, to Town Square Park? It's going to be children under 5 also. If we don't have anything at the playground that they could safely play on, that's not rated for them, I think we're making a little bit of a mistake. This is a play structure, and this is a really big one. This isn't something that would fit into this location, because they come in all sizes. But it has a ramp. And I did talk to you, John, in August of 2014. Mm-hmm. I remember sending you and Jim pictures mm-hmm. from Alexandria because I was so excited. Mm-hmm. I was disabled in May of 1990. My daughter was three. And I remember not being able to go play with her on playgrounds. And unless the boys were with us or a friend was with us, she couldn't play on certain playground equipment because I couldn't physically be there to help her. This not only allows a child in a wheelchair or a person like me who use crutches, but it allows everybody because it's just ramps. It's not necessarily made just for disabled children or disabled adults. It just has ramps. And it's accessible for the mom who has a toddler and a baby who wants to play on a toy. It's just readily accessible. I sent all these things to you. This isn't a new thing that I brought up. And I am disappointed because I think this would be a value to the city. It would be the first one in the city of Federal Way. Other cities have these play structures. This park is going to be the highlight of downtown Federal Way. And this park needs something to draw people to it. It'll have the splash park, but for 3, maybe 4 months at the most out of the year. And the rest of the year, they'll be playing on the basketball field, walking on the beautiful park, the trail, or playing on the toys. And I think that this would be of value to the park. So, that's what I have to say. This isn't a new discussion that we've had. We've had it for many, many months. And, you know, the park will be pretty, whatever we choose. But as I'm hearing you talk to us tonight, everything is rated for a child 5 and over at the play at Town Square Park. Let's remember those that are younger. Thank you.
All right. Was this considered a committee? Was this brought forward?
Pictures like that, Councilmember Honda did send those photos and others of ramped facilities that were presented at council in May of 2015.
All right, Councilmember Kopang, do you have a motion?
Wait
a second. I have a question, please.
Yeah, please. Sorry.
On the zip line.
Mm-hmm.
How high off the ground is that?
We said the seat level was about 2 feet off the ground. We believe.
Okay.
Yes. 2 feet.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. I just wanted to reiterate that as a member of that commission, I do remember seeing the pictures that you brought, Councilmember Honda, and the commission did review them and consider them in putting together the plan that we finally came up with.
All right. Councilmember Kopang, do you have a motion?
I do. I have a motion to approve the Town Square Park playground equipment as presented.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion or further discussion?
Yes.
Go ahead. No, but you go.
Councilmember Honda.
Oh, I would like to ask us to take a two weeks, it's not going to be forever, to think about this again and to look at all of the available toys. I'm really concerned if we need something for younger children to play on at that park. Maybe not this, but something that is rated for children that are younger than 5.
All right.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt. We could explore switching something out to the 2 to 5 age group. We can look at that and see what might fit within the footprint of the play area. That's a possibility. We could look at that. But again, this was the spray park is going to be hugely popular with children of all ages, from any kid who's walking up to these ages. And we know because a toy is rated 5 to 12, kids younger than 5 are going to be on it and having fun.
All right. There's a motion, a second, and there's a call for discussion. Councilmember Maloney.
Thank you. There's a lot of back and forth tonight, and I just want to say that I'm really disappointed in how this was presented. Because it felt like a gang up, like, you know, you knew that this was coming, and it felt as if the ducks were in a row. And I would like to be a little more respectful to have council members who have an opposing view have a little more respect paid to them. And on this particular issue, I do agree with Councilmember Honda that we should explore, some other options. And again, not just 2 to 5 years old or something like that, but also the more accessible type of play equipment, as she presented.
Councilmember Maloney, this has gone through commission, it's gone through committee, it's on the consent agenda for that reason. So there's no gang up. This was actually on the consent agenda, and when it was pulled, we actually had our director and the deputy director give a presentation. So there is no gang up. This is a presentation by city staff of which we've all had the opportunity to discuss. So the chair takes exception to any sort of characterization that there's been sort of any gang up. This has been a very civil conversation, which everybody's had an opportunity to discuss. There's been a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion?
Yes.
Councilmember Sepadasa. Yeah.
Thank you. And thank you for the presentation. And last week I was also at the meeting, so saw these, and they are great play equipment. And I failed to even think about the younger kids. And so thank you for bringing it up. And I think we need to consider that population, and I do appreciate you bringing it up, because I think, this is something that's going to draw families with little children, and also, and I know these are also accessible, right, from my understanding, all these equipment. So I appreciate that also, but I really do think we need to consider the younger kids. So whatever it takes to make that decision, if we need to pull it for another conversation, I think we should.
Councilmember Coping, and then Councilmember Moore.
Go ahead.
Councilmember Moore.
In fact, going back to what Councilmember Honda said, I wasn't sure if that was a friendly amendment or another motion, but I would also favor and second a motion to pull it back off the agenda, discuss it for 2 weeks tops, no further discussion, because I recognize the fact that we've discussed this quite a bit, but I would favor that motion.
I just have a simple concern for me is that we have a procedure in place as a council, and we have commissions, and then we have committees. And the Town Square Park playground equipment became a part of the consent agenda as a result of discussion at our committee. And Councilmember Honda was in attendance at the committee and didn't mention this at that time. So. We're having this discussion on the dais, and I think it's a good discussion to have. But my concern is that, we're going through this process, and this process is deliberative on purpose, so that when we get to the point where we're making a decision, we've got our ducks in a row. And I think a little bit disappointed, because I feel like there was avenues for this other alternative to be brought up and to be thoughtfully considered. And can we delay it 2 weeks? Is there any financial reason for not delay? I mean, if we wanted to delay it just to defer to...
It won't change the price. We can't delay it much longer.
Right.
Because it's about 90 days to get it, and we're at about 120 days out from what we'd hope to open if we can ever get any weather.
Yeah. I know that the commission as a whole did not approve this particular idea for a number of reasons. And I think that if we took it back to the commission, they would still feel the same way. It's obviously at our level now as a committee or as a commission or a council, and certainly would like to see us move forward. But I can certainly defer to Councilmember Honda for one last, moment to consider if that's really what it's going to take.
Councilmember Duclos,
council. I need a little bit of explanation here, because I haven't been in on all of these things. First of all, is there room for other? This is very nice. Personally, I ziplined in Mexico. It was a lot higher than what that is if it's only 2 feet off the ground. But is there room for other equipment besides this?
The footprint is pretty full. It's a long linear space.
Yeah.
And so we tried to fit things in as best as we could in a linear space, which it limits what will fit Anytime you have pieces of equipment like this, there's lots and lots of national regulation for fall zones and swing zones. So swings, I believe it's double the height of the swing apparatus in the front and in the back. So if it's 10 feet high frame, it's 20 feet swing in the back, 20 feet. So you need 40 feet to fit a swing set in. So it's a long, narrow space. We don't have a lot of extra room. Am I correct on that, Steve?
I could clarify that there are two additional pieces that have been selected that we've held off for the time being because we needed to see where all this budget was going to land and make sure there wasn't any hidden problems underground, which we actually did find under the restroom and we're correcting now. So we did hold off on those two other spinning and turning type that are for smaller kids. So we could look at how this layout is and just see if we can fit something else. Typically on these playgrounds, when you have two age groups like this, you might reflect back to Funland. We have that upper area and also our ability world area. That's the 2 to 5 year olds. Two to five year olds is that upper area. We try to keep them separated a little bit just because of the nature of the kids running in the older age group. So trying to find an isolated area, I think, is what was taken into account during the commission and public discussions is, okay, well, how do you isolate this long linear piece? And that's where it really fit well with the zip cruise and some of these other smaller spinning apparatuses. So bottom line is, could we find an isolated spot off to one side? We just have to take these and lay it out a little bit differently and see if we can find a little bit of real estate in one side or in a corner for the 2 to 5 year olds.
Okay, well, I just, you know, I really, having served on commissions before I ran for and got elected to the council, I hate to go against the commission because I know the work that people put into those and the questions they raise. And this equipment looks good. If there's some way that we can accommodate some of the younger children or something, that would be helpful too. But I really hate to go against the commission because I know they do their work and they ask their questions and they come up with recommendations. And I know they get real upset when we don't follow them.
If this passed, would there be a way to accommodate younger ages?
Well, we do have two more pieces of equipment that are planned for the play area. They're not reflected in the four pieces that we talked about tonight, the Explorer Dome and these three. There's two more additional pieces, and as Steve said, we're kind of waiting on budget. They're planned for the playground. We're waiting just to make sure we're okay completely, and we could certainly look at those two pieces if we can get that small separation just to make sure kids are safe and the little kids don't get run over by bigger kids in their excitement to play. So we can definitely look at smaller children friendly for the 2 to 5 age group for those additional two pieces.
Just swap out the allocation for those into the 2 to 5 year old.
Okay. All right.
I have
an option.
Councilmember Honda.
First of all, I'd like to respond to something that Councilmember Kopang said. I was not at the meeting last week. I was here at City Hall, but I was at the school board meeting as I was requested to be there. And secondly, we do have a process here at the City Council. That's why we have a consent agenda. That's why we ask if something needs to be pulled from the consent agenda. Not every council member goes to every city commission committee meeting, excuse me. And that's why things go on the consent agenda. If we feel like we're going to be, I'll use the words, attacked because we pull something from the consent agenda. What council member in their right mind would pull something from the consent agenda? Well, I'm looking because your playground stuff is right above your head. So, well, I'm not saying that anyone attacked me, but I'm using, but I certainly did feel like you were very angry with me. And
I'm not angry with you at all.
Okay, well, could I finish? Thank you. So I appreciate the process that we have because as council members, it's our job to ask questions. I don't want a park that's just built for 5-year-olds to 12-year-olds. We have the basketball fields or the hoops for the older kids too. Let's think of all of the kids that we have in Federal Way. And secondly, not everyone is equally physically capable. Some people have issues with walking. Some people have issues with other things. I appreciate what the commission did. I don't know how many times I can say that, but as a council, our job is to review what commissions do, and sometimes, unfortunately, you might not agree with that, and that's our job. So I would appreciate it if we could look more into this as to what we could offer for the younger children and perhaps what we could offer for other people. Thank you very much.
All right, for now, what's on the floor is a motion and a second in favor of item F. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed?
Oh, no. I'm sorry.
We are voting on, there was a motion and a second for approval of Town Square Park playground equipment as set forth in those in that charrette, with the understanding that there is an opportunity with two other playground equipment to provide for younger children. So it's been moved, it's been seconded, we've had discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Nay.
Nay.
Nay. All right.
Deputy Mayor Burbidge?
Nay.
Councilmember Assefa Dawson? Councilmember Assefa Dawson?
Aye.
Councilmember Maloney?
Nay.
Councilmember Honda?
Nay.
Councilmember Copeng?
Aye.
Councilmember Moore?
Nay.
Councilmember Duclos?
Aye.
The motion fails 3-4.
All right, now Deputy Mayor Burbidge.
I have a question. Would it be possible to move forward with item F and add to that a request to look at an additional item for the park?
Could you say that again, just so everybody could hear?
Would it be possible to move forward with item F, which would include the three, and also add the request to look into an additional feature for the park that would address the younger group?
That's what we just voted on.
Look at the last two pieces that have not been part of what we're asking to purchase here, or the Explorer Dome. There's two more pieces planned for the space. We agreed that we would look at 2 to 5 year old pieces for those two remaining pieces as part of this. So.
Okay. I'm sorry.
Are you?
Well, I'm not sure that was absolutely clear as being part of the motion,
right.
The looking at the exactly. Other additional okay. items. So I would move that we move forward with item F with the addition of the review and of a piece of equipment that would address the younger age group.
Okay. I'll second.
All right, it's been moved and seconded. Let's make sure we kind of navigate our way through this. It's been moved and seconded that we move forward with item F, but that the remaining two items be geared, that the council would direct that the remaining two items be geared toward younger children below ages 5. Councilmember Maloney, for purposes of discussion.
Thank you. Now, is that if we have the funds for them, or is that in replacing two of those?
Well, it would be in addition to.
If we have the funds. Or because
well,
I thought we didn't have the funds.
We haven't come forward yet. We wanted to kind of see where we were budget. Today, it looks like we should be fine to buy two more pieces, and we would look at those two new pieces being, rather than the ones that we had selected, being aged 2 to 5.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Councilmember Assefa Dawson.
Yeah. Maybe I was confused when we voted earlier. I want to make sure that the equipments are part of this agreement or part of what we voted on, right. If that makes sense.
Right, that there'd be two additional, that they would be
yeah.
two additional pieces that they would be for younger children younger than 5.
Correct.
Is that, you do understand that?
Correct, right. So this would, if I'm understanding correctly, this would carry the last two pieces that we'd be researching and trying to put in there, making sure that we put in ages 2 to 5. Unless it was just completely physically impossible, but we don't think that would be the case.
Okay.
We think it'll work.
And that's the motion, the second before us. Councilmember Moore.
Yeah, I also want to add, because of this photo that was we were looking at, it had a lot of talk and conversation about disabilities. And I want to make sure that new two equipments are with the focus of disabilities.
Okay. Well, they would certainly be ADA compliant. And
yeah, they have
would
ADA,
you
they
would you guarantee the council that that's something that you would look at and be sensitive to?
Absolutely. If we can, if there were a way that would, but that ADA compliancy will be guaranteed. That's all we buy.
All right.
But I, if we're talking about wheelchair, probably not. That's probably, I mean, that's a completely different animal. We have one of the very best, the very first one installed in the United States is a block and a half away. Unbelievable, the ability world. But I can't guarantee you that it would be a wheelchair, but certainly ADA.
All right, is there any more discussion? All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right, it appears unanimous, we move forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
That's unanimous the hard way. All right, good. All right.
Good job.
Wow, rough crowd. All right, council business, resolution. Amendments, a resolution, amendments to council rules of procedure, staff presentation, city attorney, Amy Jo Pearsall.
This is gonna be easy after that. Because you've all already agreed to everything that's in this document. So, these are the three rules that we discussed and gained consensus on at your council retreat. So before you is a proposed resolution that incorporates those three amendments to the council rules, and we'll go through each of them right now. So the first one is council rule 3.5. That's on page 6 of your council rules. And it currently states that publication of the final agenda and complete council packet will occur no later than the Friday prior to the council meeting. And the change is that the agendas will now be available prior to the Thursday prior to the council meeting at 5 p.m. And the council packet, the full council packet will remain Friday at 5 p.m. So that's the first one. The second one is Council Rule 19.10. The rule currently states that applicants already serving on a commission may be reappointed without being interviewed again. The proposed change included today is that when a term expires, the vacancy will be advertised and open to all applicants. So there's been new language added that basically addresses vacancies under two conditions. One is at the end of a term, and so when that happens, the vacancy created by the expiration of a term, we will advertise the availability of that open position to the public. The citizen that's currently serving is still welcome to apply, but everyone will be interviewed and as a, just like a normal appointment, and that's already outlined in 19.9. And so basically the incumbent will have to compete against any new applicants, and then council can choose the most qualified. With regard to vacancies midterm, the way that this is drafted, if there's an alternate that's already been interviewed within the past year, they can be moved into that voting position without an interview if you'd like. But if the alternate hasn't been interviewed within that past 12 months, they would be re-interviewed before they're put into that position. So that's how those two different appointments work. Council Rule 20.8, this was the rule that stated that the deputy mayor may serve as ex officio or be appointed to a committee. It wasn't clear what ex officio meant. It wasn't clear why there was an or in there. So the change that's being presented would allow the deputy mayor to participate as a voting member only if a quorum is needed. So that language is here. So, and I put in parentheses after ex officio voting so that we're clear what that means. So the deputy mayor may serve as an ex officio parens voting member of a committee when a quorum of a committee is not available. If during a meeting when the deputy mayor is serving as an ex officio member, a quorum of committee members and a quorum of committee members appears at the meeting, then the deputy mayor would no longer serve as an ex officio member unless there's a pending matter for the committee that the deputy mayor has participated in the discussions and is ready to vote. So that was sort of the balance between when the deputy mayor would no longer be an ex officio, but if the new person coming in hadn't participated in any of the discussion up to that point. So that was the balance that I heard from you at the council retreat And so so we'll need to discuss. Those are the three that I believe we're ready to move forward on. Two items that we're not ready to discuss yet are Rule 19.8, and that's about the appointment of members to advisory groups and to commissions. We're currently researching. It appears that most other cities with strong mayors, that the mayor is the one that appoints those commission members, and that's confirmed by the council. But we will bring all that research to you at a future study session. And that's similarly with Section 16, which sets forth the council's travel and expenses. We have a very large process outlined in the council rules about how money can or can't be spent, but there's no process for who actually makes the decisions on that. And so we're currently gathering, again, all that research from other cities, and we'll provide you with options, and we'll get feedback from you at a future study session so that we can discuss those two final rules. But the items before you tonight in the resolution are the three rules that we've just gone through.
Councilmember Honda.
Thank you, Amy Jo. On the additional items, Rule 19.8 states council appoints all members of all advisory groups. At this point, the mayor does appoint to at least two, right?
Correct.
That's correct.
So yeah. Those would remain the same?
That would remain the same, and the council rule would have to be updated for that purpose anyway. For whatever reason, the council rule was never updated when we switched to change our form of government. And yes, he appoints to Independent Salary Commission, which is then confirmed by council, and he appoints to the Civil Service Commission, which actually has no council involvement at all per the statute.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
All right, council, any other questions?
Yeah, quick clarification. Who appoints the Ethics Committee members?
Right now, that is a council appointment.
It is council. Okay, thank you.
Okay, council, any other questions? All right, Deputy Mayor Burbage, do you have a motion?
I do. I move approval of the proposed resolution amending the City Council Rules of Procedure.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? She was right. It was easy. All right. So now, moving on to ordinances, second reading, item A. Council Bill number 704, City of Tacoma Department of Public Utilities, Light Division Franchise Extension. Deputy City Clerk, please read the ordinance title. I'm not used to saying Deputy City Clerk, but Jennifer, it's good to have you here tonight. Go ahead and please read the ordinance title.
Oh, thank you. Council Bill 704, City of Tacoma Department of Public Utilities, Light Division Franchise Extension. An ordinance of the City Council of the City of Federal Way, Washington, extending the term of the franchise agreement established in Ordinance 06517 and granting the City of Tacoma Department of Public Utilities Light Division a non-exclusive franchise to occupy rights of way of the City of Federal Way, Washington through the franchise area within the specified franchise area for purposes of constructing, maintaining, repairing, and operating an electrical light and power system within and through the City of Federal Way.
All right, thank you very much, Jennifer. Councilmember Ducal, do you have a motion?
Yes, I move approval of the proposed ordinance.
I'd second it.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? All right, matter passes unanimously. Item Bill, Council Bill 705, New Singular Wireless Franchise. Would the Deputy City Clerk please read the ordinance title?
Council Bill 705, New Singular Wireless Franchise. An ordinance of the City Council of the City of Federal Way, Washington, granting New Singular Wireless, PCS LLC, a Delaware limited liability company, a non-exclusive franchise to occupy rights of way of the City of Federal Way, Washington, within the specified franchise area for the purposes of installation, operation, maintenance, and repair of its wireless communications fixtures and related equipment, cables, accessories, and improvements in a portion of the rights of way within and through the City of Federal Way.
All right, Councilmember Duclos.
I move approval of the proposed ordinance.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Matter passes unanimously. Council reports. Councilmember Duclos.
Thank you. I'll try to cut it down because I see the hour is late. Earlier this month, I visited two classes over at Thomas Jefferson High School, and they wanted to learn a little bit about city government, how it works, the mayor, the council, and I said, we just don't work together at all. No. Actually, a little levity here, okay? Yeah. Actually, the first class was very subdued and didn't ask any questions at all.
or a few questions about it. But the next day, it was like day and night. I mean, they were just asking questions left and right about how we work, how we get along, what we do, and how do we relate to one another and with the mayor, and how we work within the city. And I told them all about our commissions. I told them about the youth commission, and some kids were really anxious about that, but I also told them that they had to be within the boundaries of the city of Federal Way, which was kind of a little disappointing, but I told them they could move or we could annex them or anything. It was really quite interesting, though, and we've got some fine students out there, and we've got some fine youth coming up, and they'll be sitting up here sometime. Let's see. I also attended the Policy Issues Committee of the Sound Cities Association. We had quite an agenda. Chief of Staff was there, as well as Michael Morales, and they talked about the methanol plant. I was a little disappointed because I didn't think the members of the group really understood that it's a regional issue, not just a jurisdiction issue between two cities. And I hope we could explain that a little bit better to them, because that plume is going to go all over the place if it happens. It's not going to just be located in Federal Way in Des Moines and Tacoma. It'll get up to Seattle. It'll get up north. And so somehow maybe we can reach out to them a little bit more and try to have them understand that. There were several other issues, and there was a lot of interest over the overview of Sound Transit 3's long-range plan, and the additional funding for it is a property tax up to 25 cents for each $1,000 assessed valuation for your home. So they're figuring about $75 annually for a $3,000 home, and then a sales tax up to an additional 0.5% or 50 cents on a $100 purchase, and a motor vehicle excise tax of up to 0.8% of vehicle value, which would be like $80 on a $10,000 vehicle or $240 on a $30,000 vehicle. If you're buying a new vehicle, you're looking at $30,000 or more, having just gone around and priced a few. So that was a little bit disturbing. And other items were an update on the legislative session, Best Start for Kids. On March 2nd, I had the honor of opening the night over at the Aquatic Center, Pac 15 swim meet. And that was really kind of interesting. It was really, really full with a lot of families, and there was a lot of support there. And it still amazes me when I see these people dive into the water and they don't come up until they're almost at the other end where they have to turn around. And I was asking the manager of the place, and he said there's a strip under there that they have to surface by. Otherwise, they could get all the way to the end and come back. So they have to swim, come up to the surface and start swimming. But it's really nice, and that's a beautiful facility, and Federal Way is so lucky to have that here. And it does draw a lot of people who stay in hotels, so our motel and our lodging tax should be increased. And finally, I want to give kudos to our own animal control unit. When I had to ask for their assistance when I was walking my dog one morning and we were attacked by two dogs. And he's okay, yeah. A little shook up, and I was very shook up. But I came over here and filled out a whole report, and they went right out and contacted that homeowner, and I haven't seen those dogs since. Of course, I carry a club with me now, because if I do, they won't be attacking anybody else. But so kudos to our animal control unit, and that's the end of my report.
All right, thank you. Councilmember Moore.
Yes, I'm glad to hear that Dwight's doing pretty well. Dwight is Councilmember Duclos' dog, very sweet dog if you haven't seen him.
I didn't name him that, though.
What?
I didn't name him that. I took him from a shelter.
Well, I love the name. So it's great, and it's such a great, great dog, loving dog. My fiance and I, we've been on a play kick. We've been going out and seeing all these short plays, and the latest one that we went to was Jersey Boys. If you have not seen that, I think it may be too late. It was only here for a week, so sorry to build that climax there, but it was an amazing show. I know that 2 weeks ago I talked about the last play I attended, but I just get so excited about what could be right here in our own backyard. And certainly I recognize the great work that Center Stage has been doing as well. And I look forward to going to their place. The next player I'm going to be going to is The Willy Wonka Jr. by Roald Dahl. My future brother-in-law is going to be directing that play. And in case any of my colleagues would like to go, it's going to be at St. Luke's Memorial Episcopal Place. And I'm looking forward to attending that on my birthday, March 18th. So how about that? What a wonderful gift.
Are you looking for presents?
Nope.
He wants us to sing.
Nope, nope. I certainly don't want that either. But yes. Went to the Parks Powell meeting yesterday. It's obviously a nonprofit organization that advocates for dog-friendly parks. They proposed some new ideas. I'm looking forward to working with the chair to introduce those ideas and concepts to our Parks Committee. I know that I've been meeting with my colleagues, and just want to say thank you for taking the time to meet with me and discuss very important issues. I really have enjoyed today's council meeting. It certainly brings the legislative power to reality, and I appreciate that, because there's a lot of authenticity when that happens. And appreciate our conversation on homelessness, and I'm really eager to be working on that issue this year and others. Look forward to working with that in our committee and with our council. A lot more to report, but with that, I'll end my report on that.
All right, Councilmember Copang.
I want to, couple of weeks, I had the pleasure of attending a few events, one of them being the Chamber Luncheon, which was Dr. Tammy Campbell presented the state of the education in the Federal Way Public School System. And I tell you, it was such a pleasure to be able to hear her speak about her vision and hear the stories about the success that's already been achieved in Federal Way Public Schools. Long road to go, but I feel that we're in very good hands with her, and that the public schools, Federal Way Public Schools, is a great partner for the city. I also attended the Federal Way Mirrors Best Of, and got to see a lot of deserving companies receive the recognition that they work so hard for. And got to see our own Susan Honda even recognized as the most popular public official. So,
again.
Yes. Yeah. And I wanted to finish up my comments by talking about a cause that I think is timely. This month is March of Diapers. And it is a very, there's a lot of reasons for it. I think diapers are not covered by social welfare systems like WIC or food stamps. Families sometimes are forced to ration their diapers and basically limit their kid to one diaper a day, which is, as a father who's changed more than a few diapers, that's a tough thing to have to go through. And I can certainly remember as a young parent appreciating the raise that I got when I didn't have to buy diapers anymore. So it's certainly a big expense. And for those that are less fortunate, it really becomes a hardship not to be able to have that. And I wanted to recognize Cheryl Hurst. Cheryl, I think we should make you an honorary citizen of Federal Way.
I'm moving in.
Yeah.
I'm
getting into this. I tell you, it's great to have people like Cheryl, and there's so many others. I mean, I tell you, in my all the different things that I've done, all the different groups that I've interacted with, it more often than not, you hear about people from Northeast Tacoma or from outside of Federal Way, but close by, but they want to be a part of what's going on in Federal Way, and that's such a huge blessing for the city of Federal Way. But these diaper drives are fire departments buying in, the police department, local churches, local businesses. Just for those of you in the community that want to contribute to this, you can drop off your diapers at Sub-Zero, at Flagler & Associates, at the Multi-Service Center, at Umpqua Bank, at Lake Haven and St. Luke's. So if you're a former diaper changer, remember those times and go ahead and contribute to this cause. So thank you. That concludes my remarks.
All right. Councilor Honda.
Mayor, excuse me. If we could have a motion to suspend the rules and go past 10, please.
I so move.
Second.
All right. It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? All right. Councilmember Hunt.
Is that the right time? Did it?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I guess half the clocks in my house are still in the wrong time. I would like to, I certainly have attended a lot of events lately. The Chamber quarterly meeting, which is a really great place where we can, as a city council, go and meet with other the business people here in Federal Way and the chamber. The city was there, the school district was there, the fire and water were there, along with the business people, so that was a really good meeting. I attended the King County DVI board meeting last week, and we heard about Best Starts there also. I was at the PAC 12 again. I was able to go twice this year while they were here. On the last Friday that they were here, and I was there to give awards out, but one of the coaches wanted to give awards out to his swimmers, and so I was able to welcome them for the second time. And I talked about the park downtown and the new PAC that's being built, and when they come here next year that they will be able to see those things. But I would like to give a big thank you to Mike Dinwiddie for his, all of the work he does. He promotes Federal Way from here all around the, actually all around the world, because he brings swimmers all around the world to come to Federal Way, Washington to swim at the King County Weyerhaeuser Aquatic Center. So really great job. And the last thing I would say is that I have had the very great honor and pleasure of working with three students at Todd Beamer for the last several months, and with Sherry Edwards. And they approached, one of the students approached me months ago, and she wanted to do something to raise awareness of youth homelessness. And her name's Anastasia. And I met with her. I asked Sherry Edwards to come with me because Sherry knows a lot about what's going on in the homeless community. I called in Auburn Youth Resources to work with us and the school district. Last week we had the opportunity to sit down with the school superintendent, and she talked with us, and we now have three students working on this, and out of this came not one project but three projects. And I would just have to say that our kids in Federal Way are amazing and fantastic. And these students are going to go really far. They're all seniors, which I'm kind of sad that they're seniors, because I'd love to have another year to work with them. But whatever they do in life, they are going to do amazing work. And they started here in Federal Way, Washington. And I'd also like to give a shout out to Mike Bressler. He's a wrestling coach at Decatur. He started coaching my son in, back in junior high school at Saghalie. All these these group of boys learned how to wrestle at Saghalie, and then they went to Decatur. And by the time they were done at Decatur, Decatur had won a lot of honors, and the wrestling program just grew and grew and grew. And Mike Bressler is retiring after a really great career. And I would just like to say thank you to him, and thank you to all coaches who work with our kids, because they go the extra mile for our kids. Thank you.
Councilmember Maloney.
Thank you. One of the drawbacks of being on this side of where the council report starts is that people have already mentioned a lot of what you've done. And that certainly is true in this case. So I have been, I did participate in the PAC 12 at the Aquatic Center, and that was really rewarding to me as well, to see the place filled up with all those kids and families. And of course, as was mentioned, that means people in our hotels. I also attended the quarterly government or city chamber function, where the mayor did a phenomenal job of updating business representatives and everyone who had been mentioned already on city initiatives. And let's see what else in terms of things that have already been mentioned. Oh, I attended the Chamber State of the Schools address, and that was very interesting. Some things that haven't been mentioned are, well, for one, my daughter got married last weekend, so I'm very excited about that. She married a wonderful young man. We just adore him. They've been dating about 4 years, almost 4 years, and so anyway, it was really great. We had a lot of fun. Other things more city related. I've been working with the economic development director and the mayor on bringing some business and industry to the city, and I appreciate the partnership. when I introduce businesses that might be willing to move here, I definitely appreciate that you are on top of that and willing to work to help us join us in the city. Let's see, what else do I have? Well, there are a couple of other initiatives that I've been working on that I won't mention at the moment, but the last thing I'll just mention is that in addition to Councilmember Honda winning the, what is it called? Whatever the award is. Public official of the year.
City leader, I think.
We also have the mayor won the same award, and as did Councilmember Duclo, if I understand that. You were nominated. I thought you won as well.
No.
Oh, okay.
But it's an honor to be nominated.
Yes, absolutely.
And be in such heady company.
Exactly. So. But I think it just shows the caliber of our, you know, the people who are up here. So I really appreciate that. So.
Councilmember Sepadasa.
Thank you. Yeah, a lot of the stuff was said here, so it's off my list. However, the community diaper drive. I'm sorry.
Diaper dive. It's gonna take a long
time. Okay, I'm back. The only thing I want to add to it is to bring wipes with the diapers, which you didn't mention. So
yes.
That's important.
Good point.
And the Step Up Color Run that's coming up on the 26th. It's through the Free the Children, and Anastasia is one of the people putting it together. And I too am proud of her and all what the youth are doing here in Federal Way. They're just great leaders, like you said. I do agree with you. And Free the Children really promotes and encourages local and global initiative that the kids are working on. So this is one of their global initiative, and so hopefully our community would go out and support what they are doing. And on March 31st, I am going to be attending the Best Starts for Kids meeting, and I'm looking forward to that because it's a continuation of this conversation that we're having around homelessness and supporting our kids. And I just want to apologize for the confusion earlier, because I do, and thank you so much, John, for the presentation, and thank you for all the work you're doing, because I think, it goes back to how important it is to support our younger children. So if I created a confusion, I just want to apologize, and thank you, Deputy Mayor, for clarifying that. So I'm glad it turned out the way it did, and thank you very much.
Thank you. Deputy Mayor Burbridge.
Thank you very much. I attended a breakfast briefing at the Chamber last Thursday that featured Sound Transit and King County Metro. And we've pretty much heard the updates from Sound Transit, but there was a good reminder there that Sound Transit 3, which will bring light rail farther south through Federal Way, will be on the ballot in the fall. So we need to be paying attention, very close attention to that. But I was also very encouraged to have both agencies there, and they obviously are working closely together in their planning. But I was also encouraged to hear that King County Metro is working toward much greater provision of a local transit network. And I would appreciate, and I think other council members would as well, and people in the community, having more information on that planning process, on the specifics of it. I formerly served on the Regional Transit Committee, and because I'm no longer on that committee, I don't hear the detail that I formerly did. So I think that could be very useful. I also wanted to mention regarding what Councilmember Martin Moore said of his attending plays. I would recommend highly Center Stage's current production of Death on the Supermarket Shelf, which is a kind of a fascinating title for a play. But I attended it opening night, and found it to be very well done and innovative also in its use of some music that I thought might be kind of intrusive with a play, but it was, I thought it really enhanced the drama. And the staging was very well done. So I recommend that highly. This morning I attended a meeting of the South County Area Transportation Board. We had an update on the Alaskan Way Viaduct replacement program and a report on the King County Bridges and Roads Task Force having to do with the transportation road and bridge needs in unincorporated King County. And also a very good, very excellent presentation by our own Rick Perez regarding a proposal for funding for the city of Federal Way that is one of the projects being recommended by the South County Transportation Board as an application for funding from the Puget Sound Regional Council. And these funds would be used for the city center adaptive traffic control system, which could serve to greatly improve the congestion relief because of the coordination of the signal system and the interactivity of that would be allowed. He put together some written material that was shared, and I think other council members would probably be interested in that as well, so that we are all aware of the value of this project going forward and can refer to it in the various regional meetings that we attend. And that's my report.
All right.
Thank you.
Oh, Councilmember Honda.
We took a vote down here and we decided that we should sing happy birthday to Councilmember.
All right.
But
I so moved.
I don't start it because I can't sing according to my sisters. So.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Martin. Happy birthday to you.
Thank you. Perfect end to a great meeting. Thank you, everybody. Good job. You're adjourned.